Good morning and welcome to the seventh and the final meeting in 2016 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. Welcome to our witnesses and welcome to those who are in the public gallery. Just remind members as usual to put their mobile phones into the appropriate mode. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 5 in private. Are members agreed? Members have agreed. The second item on our agenda is to take evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission as part of our scrutiny of the draft budget for 2017-18. And we're joined for this session by Lady Susan Rice, who's the chair of the SFC, Professor Campbell Leith, who's a commissioner, Professor Charles Nolan, also a commissioner, and Sean Neill, who's the chief executive. And I very much warmly welcome our witnesses to our proceedings this morning. And can I invite Lady Rice to make an opening statement?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to all of you, and thank you for having us back. I'd like to say a few words about the Commission first, and then make a brief comment on each of the devolved taxes, and I will canter through. Since we last met in October, the Commission has published its report on draft budget 2017-18, along with an accompanying non-technical summary. Following 11 scrutiny meetings, we independently concluded that the government's forecasts were reasonable. And as is our wont, and you'll know this, we also identified a number of areas for continued improvement in the forecast methodologies. Now, as this is the final year in which we will scrutinize the Scottish Government's forecasts and make a judgment about whether they're reasonable, before we take on that responsibility for forecasting within the Commission, these recommendations, these suggestions are actually to ourselves, but I point that out. From next April, we'll begin to produce our own independent forecasts of Scottish tax revenues and Scottish onshore GDP. And with that in mind, the work of the Commission has evolved considerably over the past year. We were joined in the summer by a small team to manage the transition of the Commission to a non-ministerial department, and Sean Neill has been our interim chief executive since that time. I'm pleased to report that so far the project is progressing pretty smoothly. It's a lot of work, but we are making progress as we anticipated. Permanent staff will begin to join the Commission from January, and our way of working will further develop as we take on our new responsibilities. Now, returning to this year's work, I do want to say that the interim team has given us a lot of support in preparing the report for this year, but I really do have to call out the incredible amount of work that Professors Leith and Nolan did in creating the report, and personally thank them. For this year's work, we developed the beginning of protocol with the Scottish Government to set out clearly how we would interact with them for this year's budget process. And I particularly want to note the high level of cooperation and transparency in our discussions with the Scottish Government. We really appreciated that because it's greatly facilitated our ability to scrutinize properly and thoroughly the forecast methodologies. In each case, the Commission looked for evidence to support the approach adopted by the Scottish Government. Now, as you know, it's not the role of the Commission to determine how the Scottish Government produces its forecasts. That's up to the Scottish Government. But where the Commission felt there might be benefit from different or additional perspectives, we've shared those ideas with the forecasters. In each case, the forecasters themselves choose whether or not to pursue or adopt these alternative approaches. You will have seen in our report that it includes some sensitivity analysis, some what-ifs is what I would call them, as a way to deepen understanding of some of what might be important drivers of individual forecasts. Last year, our report quadrupled in size from the first year. We should all be grateful that we showed some constraint this year, and we only doubled in size from last year. But it has become increasingly detailed and increasingly technical because the models have evolved, because we now have outturn data to consider, because we've added the income tax into this year's report, and because we've shared, through example, the nature of some of the approaches we've taken and may likely take in the future to flex the forecasts. So we're giving a bit of a preview in that sense. And because of this increased complexity, we've tried at the same time to improve accessibility to the report by publishing a non-technical summary for the first time, along with using additional media, such as Twitter, to communicate the work to a wider range of audiences. And we'll continue to take this approach. We're keen to learn from these approaches because we want our reports to be accessible as well as authoritative. I'll now turn to a very brief overview of our main conclusions. This is the first year that we've been asked to provide independent scrutiny of the forecasts of income tax liabilities. Forecasting income tax liabilities is indeed a complex task. The Scottish Government has developed a model building on demographic changes and growth in income. In reaching our assessment on the reasonableness of their forecasts, we focus particularly on their projections of earnings and employment growth. The Commission considers the forecasts produced by the government to be reasonable. We've also identified a number of areas where we feel additional research and model development is required to improve the quality of the forecasts in the future, in particular in relation to judgments around behavioral effects, how people will react to changes in tax policy. The evidence base in Scotland to inform such judgments is really limited, so it's not possible to be definitive about these. Looking ahead, it'll be important to keep under review our understanding of these issues, consider whether evidence exists or might be generated that could shed further light on them in a Scotland-specific setting. So we'll be building a lot of data and observations in the future. So that for income tax, the forecast for residential LBTT, land and buildings transaction tax revenues this year are lower than last year, in part due to evidence that the housing market may be somewhat weaker than previously expected, but really mainly due to changes in forecasting methodology and changes in the base numbers that went into the forecasts. In contrast, the forecast for additional dwelling supplement revenues, ADS, is higher than last year because we now have some available outturn data that's improved our understanding of the scale of additional homes in Scotland. Information is still limited, however, especially around the refund rate, and this is something we'll be monitoring with interest in the future. Non-residential LBTT forecasting hasn't actually changed much from the budget process last year. However, we still feel there may be scope to explore using more Scotland-specific macroeconomic data to underpin the forecast for this tax. Again, something we intend to explore in the future. And then Scottish landfill tax, on the other hand, has seen a dramatic shift in forecast methodology away from a simple target-based approach, which we had challenged in the past, and towards an approach that's centered around forecasting tonnages that will be sent to landfill. Initial work has been done to understand the link between the wider macroeconomy and waste arisings, and this is something we can develop further. There are a couple of other areas we'll keep a close eye on, the development of incinerator capacity in Scotland. There are lots of plans. They need to happen. And the policies that local authorities and waste management companies adopt to ensure that the ban on biodegradable municipal waste going to landfill is successful when it's introduced. These will both have an impact on the tonnages sent to landfill and therefore on the revenue from landfill tax. We'll also become responsible for NDR, non-domestic rate income forecasts from next year, and plan to continue the government's engagement with key stakeholders in this area to deepen our understanding of the main risks to this forecast, especially around large-scale development projects. In a smaller environment, very large projects can lead to a certain amount of volatility. Those are my comments. I would close simply with a reminder that the Scottish Government has produced these forecasts and that the Commission has taken an independent view of the reasonableness of these forecasts. But we've also begun to anticipate our new remit, and a lot of that is trailed through the report as well. If our report doubled in size last year, I think my opening remarks have as well. So I want to thank you for your patience, and I now invite members, the convener and members of the Finance Committee, to give us any feedback you have about the report and obviously to ask your questions. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. The paper growth may have slowed, but I guess the level of growth, the Scottish economy was growing at that level, we'd all be a lot more excited. However, can we just turn to income tax forecasting, because it's obviously germane and very important about where we are. And the forecast for Scottish income tax over the period 21-22 suggests a cumulative benefit to Scotland's budget of around £1.5 billion. Some of that obviously will be a consequence of the policy decision to only increase the 40p threshold by inflation. However, a number of growth forecasts which the committee has considered anticipate the Scottish economy growing slower than the UK economy. And given this, can you shed any light on why tax revenues in Scotland are forecast to be higher than the adjustment to the block grant, which is based on the per capita income tax revenue growth in the UK?
Charles.
Well, maybe I could take the first part of that. So what drives the forecast of tax revenue on the macroeconomic front? Are the forecast paths for employment growth and aggregate earnings. These are the two main macro inputs, if you like. So the model works by, maybe I should back up slightly. So the model works by forecasting employment growth, building that up from a breakdown from HMRC data, the Survey of Personal Incomes, by age group, by income source, and by sector. So you're trying to build up the non-saving, non-dividends tax base. So you're trying to get a forecast of the number of taxpayers and their income. And employment, for those of working age, employment is the proxy for the number of taxpayers. And that's about right, because in the 13-14 SPI data, 97% of taxpayers under 65 have employment from income. And of that income, 95% is non-saving, non-dividend income. So employment is a good, employment growth is the proxy for taxpayer growth. And similarly, for most, the non-saving, non-dividend income for those over 65, it's from pensions, and that's about 80% of their non-saving, non-dividend liabilities. So you're building up the knowledge of the tax base, the taxpayers, from the bottom up in the Scottish Government's approach. So forecasting employment, consequently, becomes very important, because that's telling you, because most of the liabilities are coming from people in employment, taxpayers in employment. So that's the first part of the connection of the income tax forecast with the wider macro picture. And related to that is then, given you've got some estimate of the number of taxpayers in employment, then the key thing then is how the average earnings are growing. And there the forecast is driven by the OBR forecast for earnings, which is then incorporated in the Scottish Government's macroeconomic model to produce an average earnings profile. And then in effect, these two things are put together, and you there's lots of steps in between that I can talk about if you want, but then you put these two things together and you get a distribution of income to which you can then apply the tax code.
And there's obviously differences between what the Scottish Government are saying and what the OBR is saying in terms of forecasts. So what's driving these differences?
So there'll be two sort of generic differences. One is that the models are different. So the OBR's model of the Scottish non-saving, non-dividend tax liabilities is basically a share of the UK non-saving, non-dividend tax take. So it's calculated using the Scottish share of the overall UK tax take. So it's sometimes described as a top-down approach. So and this share is calculated using the same data that the Scottish Government are using. It's using the 13-14 SPI data, and then various changes are made to account for demographic changes, any differential impacts between how tax changes would affect the rest of the UK and Scotland. But the share's relatively constant. I mean, it's just over 7%, 7.3%, something like that. And it's been fairly constant through time. So that's one difference. The models are slightly different, so they're liable to give you slightly different answers. The second thing is that, of course, policies are slightly different now, so the higher rate threshold differs between through the forecast period will differ between Scotland and our UK, and those differences will be part of the data. But the OBR didn't include the Scottish Government's plans in their forecast. So the OBR's forecast for the tax take assumes that Scotland follows the UK government's. So there's another difference there. So that would be the two reasons why the forecasts were different.
Sorry to get into such technical stuff so early, but I think that helps us understand the overall position in terms of how we got to where we are. Ash, I think you maybe had some questions on income tax as well, am I right?
Yes. Good morning. So obviously at the moment we might have some clouds gathering over the UK economy as a result of things to do with Brexit. So the Scottish Government has made this decision not to pass on the tax cut for the top 10% of earners, as you've mentioned, the changes to the higher rate threshold. So as I understand it, 99% of taxpayers are paying no more income tax this year, but revenue will actually be up. So obviously the Scottish Government has forecasted revenue of £79 million for next year. That's increasing over the next few years. And then cumulatively, as Bruce Crawford mentioned earlier, £1.5 billion by the end of 21-22. And you've said that you consider the methodology used to come to these forecasts as being reasonable. So I believe you either have a category of reasonable or not reasonable. Are you able to give a bit more detail around why you thought they were reasonable?
Why is the income tax model reasonable? I think to answer that in a slightly generic sense, I think we, as you know, as Susan said in previous opening remarks, and as we write in our reports, we try to assess taxes and tax methodology by saying the approach taken, is there evidence for pursuing it this way? And so with the income tax model, the obvious alternative way to do this would be to do some kind of projection on income by deciles, as opposed to build it up on by the age cohorts or age groups that I mentioned. And some work was done during the year, and we discussed it in our challenge meetings. Would that approach be more accurate than building up by age cohorts? And the indications were that the age cohorts was probably more accurate. And given some of the demographic differences between Scotland and our UK, the judgment by the Scottish Government is that this modelling approach is probably more flexible for incorporating those effects if and when they arise and become material to understanding the tax take or labour market behaviour. And so it's a mixture of those kinds of discussions that you say, well, yes, there's a we don't necessarily agree with everything, but is this a reasonable approach? The approach has a rationale, it has a justification, it can be defended, it produces numbers that look reasonable. So yeah, it's a mixture of factors, and I don't know if
Susan. I could just add just to that forecasts develop over time, and I've signaled that in my opening comments as well. So this is the first year for the income tax liabilities, and we think that what they've done is reasonable. Reasonable isn't a black and white judgment. It is what it is. It's within a spectrum, and we fully expect the approach to evolve over time as we know more, do more, test more. Campbell, do you want to add to that at all?
Yes. One of the things we've kind of repeatedly said at previous meetings is that we should imagine, just as the Bank of England uses when it forecasts, we should imagine fan charts round about these forecasts. So there is quite a range of uncertainty attached to them. And one of the things we've tried to do for almost all the taxes in the report this year is to undertake some kind of sensitivity analysis. What is it that generates those fan charts? What is it that generates the main likely sources of divergence from forecast that we'll ultimately observe? And in the case of income tax, the key driver is nominal wage growth. So we've spent a lot of time looking at, well, suppose this was a bit lower or a bit higher than that, what would it do to the forecast? Is the nominal wage growth forecast from the macro forecast, is it a reasonable forecast to employ because it's a key driver of income tax? So it's by drilling down into seeing what is materially important for driving the forecast, assessing whether we consider that to be a reasonable approach, that's what ultimately drives our assessment of reasonableness for the tax number that is ultimately generated.
So the Scottish Government have got a new model, so they're constructing more detailed forecasts now by age group, income source and sector. I think you alluded to that in your opening remarks. But you've said that it's important to further develop the economic modelling of the Scottish labour market because you think that will be important in forecasting in the future. And I'm also wondering, if some of this is based on the ONS projections on population growth, is that a little bit more complicated now because of Brexit and possible changes to free movement of people?
In terms of the population growth, so the population growth, this goes back to the modelling of taxpayers, so the population growth underpins, is the first step in calculating the future trajectory of taxpayers, so you apply a participation coefficient to that, so not everyone will be working, so a proportion will be working, a proportion will be unemployed, and then what's left is the forecast for employment. And so the ONS principal population projections are used, which is what the OBR have used in their most recent forecast to accommodate their latest thinking on Brexit. So that's reflected in the Scottish population principal projections as well. So at the moment, in the forecast, the Brexit scenario, if you like, as it's unfolding, is reflected in the same way as it is in the OBR forecasts.
Good morning. Just to follow up on these questions, the range of impacts that we've been told could emerge from the various different models that we'll be living with post-Brexit, depending on whether the UK is inside or outside the single market, depending on whether Scotland has the same arrangement as the rest of the UK or a differentiated arrangement, the range of impacts are really quite stark. I think the most damaging from the Fraser Avalander report from a couple of months ago suggested real wages down 7%, number of people in employment down 3%, some 80,000 jobs that amounts to, as well as reductions in GDP, productivity and exports. There must be some assumptions that we're working with about what fundamental context the economy will be operating in. Can you say what that assumption is and whether when you take on the forecasting role from the Scottish Government, you'll take the same approach or will you generate different projections, different forecasts for those different assumptions about the conditions in which we'll be operating?
I'll just say something about how the Brexit situation, as it were, is reflected in the current income tax forecasts. So these are, again, because the earnings input into the income tax model, again, follows the OBR wage projections. So that reflects the assumptions that they've made and the modelling that they've produced in their current economic and fiscal outlook for the next 5 years from 17-18 onwards. And so so that earnings profile is very important for the modelling of the Scottish earnings profile. So that Brexit part is in there. The population point I just mentioned, that the principal population projections are used. And the employment profile that's incorporated in the income tax forecast is also very close to the OBR's profile as well. So in a sense, the macro forecasts that are going into the income tax model are already starting to reflect how forecasters are trying to get to grips with what Brexit means, which of course no one does know exactly at the moment what it means.
Does that mean the forecast is based on a midpoint in the range of possibilities of economic harm that will come from Brexit? Or is it based on an assumption that basically the market arrangements will be as they are at the moment, that will be inside the single market, and that therefore, if that's not the case, we'll have to revise all of this dramatically downwards?
Well, it's almost certainly that. I don't know. It's almost certainly going to be revised. I don't know whether it's going to be dramatically or it will be revised. At the moment, the way things are playing out at the moment in macroeconomic forecasts is that a couple of years down the line, the OBR are assuming that Brexit happens, and they're basically shifting down in a net trade neutral way the path for imports and exports. So they're not they're basically having a level shift down in the path for imports and exports, and that's meant to reflect more difficult international trading environment in a couple of years' time and thereafter. But they are very clear that this is a very rough and ready. They have no real sense of the detail of what the post-Brexit trade deal will look like, and this is only
really, isn't it?
Yeah, I'll let Robert Choate speak to which finger of the ear it is. But in the shorter term, though, that's not actually happened at the moment. So the trading rules haven't changed. But what's driving the short-term conjuncture, the short-term forces in the forecast are business investment starting to look much softer now and next year. A drop in the exchange rate is liable to push up inflation, and we're seeing inflation expectations starting to pick up, and that's going to squeeze real earnings further down the line. So just when business investment starts to recover, household consumption starts to soften a bit. So the next couple of years look like overall growth will soften. Beyond that, it's clearly a very difficult judgment to make on how that situation is going to evolve. And I don't think anyone does know. And I don't know if...
Up on the second part of my question about the approach you intend to take when the Commission itself takes on the forecasting function from the Scottish Government, will you take the same broad approach of trying to produce a single central forecast, or will you, I think you used the phrase fan charts a few moments ago, will you try to produce a range of forecasts based on the different scenarios that we might face, and including, for example, based on the range of different policy choices a Scottish Government might make? I mean, the idea that income tax rates and bans stay absolutely as they are at the moment until 2021 seems a bit far-fetched as well.
I don't want to commit to tie anyone's hands. I mean, I think we would always want to be looking at scenarios, and it's likely that even in a couple of years' time, the future won't be particularly clear. Some things will have been resolved, new uncertainties will have emerged. I think we would want to try and take some kind of evidence-based approach. Which sectors of the Scottish economy are likely to be more affected by difficult changes in the trading environment, or changes in international trading rules, or differential regulations? You know, will our big export industries be affected by this? You know, a lot of the EU tariffs aren't that high, but for some sectors they are, of course. If certain sectors are forced to trade under the WTO rules, you know, that could be more difficult for them. So it's really very difficult to say with any certainty, you know, how those things will play out. But I would imagine that we would want to look at various scenarios just to you can only say what your central forecast is if you know what the stuff round about it looks like too. I don't know.
Could I just add to that? I mean, we will produce a forecast as required in this area. We are not working in this area now, so what you have is what our current remit is, and I think it's absolutely fair to say that we really haven't plotted out exactly how we'll approach the issue. We know it's really important. What we have done is, in this round with the Scottish Government, we've asked them about Brexit. We've sort of said, have you been thinking about it? What have you been thinking? How have you incorporated your thinking into your forecast this year? And Charles has explained that they've drawn on the OBR approach. Probably, you know, that's a reasonable thing to do given where we are. So I think we would take away your question, and that will be part of our discussion going forward about how we'll approach this once we take on formal forecasting.
Maybe if I could just echo these comments as well. I mean, I think the OBR's approach essentially follows the consensus view of economists that Brexit will ultimately lead to a slowdown in the growth of trade, and it looks likely to slow down the rate of growth of migration as well. The exact balance between that, soft Brexit, hard Brexit, any other kind of Brexit, we just don't know yet. And I think the OBR's forecasts then, well, acknowledge that huge uncertainty, and they suggest that uncertainty will ultimately weigh on business investment. The depreciation in sterling that we've seen will weigh on real wages, and that will that will then kind of subdue consumption growth. So that's the kind of basic approach that the OBR has taken. But as things evolve and uncertainties are resolved, we'll be able to refine those forecasts when ultimately we take over the job of forecasting. Our remit is to produce a single number to inform the budget, but we would also expect to do a sensitivity analysis around that central forecast.
Thank you.
But given that the methodology adopted to the fiscal framework, the per capita process that was agreed between the Scottish and UK governments, if we've got a situation where the rest of the UK is softening at the same rate as the Scottish economy in terms of, and tax takes softening at the same rate as well. Actually, Scotland's no worse off than what we would have been because of the block grant adjustment on not be as aggressive. Have I got that about right? And that'll be something, obviously, it's not just about how you forecast, it's the impact and how the rest of the UK is behaving as well.
That relationship is indeed very important, yes.
So if the Scottish economy softens at the same pace as the UK economy, actually, because of the methodology adopted, then there'll be no impact on the Scottish on the block grant.
That's right. If the indexation method changes, I think that's right.
That's correct. Yeah.
Yeah, it's got to be the same conditions. I accept that.
That's right. That's right.
Dean, you had a question in this area as well. Is that right?
I did, thank you, Convener. It was looking at the importance of the dynamic between employment levels and average earnings for the overall income tax take. I noticed that the forecast for private sector earnings was 4.9% by 2021. Can you remind me, is that based on OBR, a Scotland derivation of OBR numbers?
That's right. It effectively reflects the OBR forecast for average weekly earnings growth.
It's slightly more complex than that,
It's put into the Scottish Government model, and then there's a forecast for annual earnings, but the forecast hours are relatively flat, so the underlying driver of the number is the OBR wage, but it does reflect wider earnings growth. Yeah.
Is that public-private split as well? So.
We're talking about the private sector just earnings growth, 4.9 at the moment, so yeah. I should explain. So then this... thanks. So the average earnings figure then comes out of the computer, and then there's an assumption about public sector pay growth, which is then deducted from that average earnings profile, which is the average of public and private sector, and that delivers your private sector profile. Sorry. Thanks, Campbell.
Thank you. I just wondered if there was any sort of bottom-up analysis as well, because I think the earnings profile in Scotland is slightly different to the earnings profile across the rest of the UK. So if we use just a pro-rata OBR top-down analysis, does that really reflect the earnings profile in Scotland?
Well, there's a couple of points you make there. So there is some manual survey of hours and earnings data that's also used in the income tax forecast model to plug the gap between the 13-14 base and the 17-18 forecast, and that reflects some more of the fine grain and the split of earnings. But the overall correlation between UK wage changes and Scottish wage changes is fairly close. There's probably not a huge issue there. One of the sensitivity analyses we did do was to change the earnings profile to see what it did. And this is one of the reasons why you do sensitivity analysis, because these assumptions are just that. They're assumptions and forecasts, so you want to... test drive them a little bit, and that's one of the test driving scenarios that we do. So you're right, the it's not a one-for-one movement between UK and Scottish wages, but it's quite close, and we test drove some alternative assumptions, and it didn't change in the near term the forecast liabilities too much. But that scenario, if it's allowed to persist for a long time, does in fact have big effects, but yeah.
So one of the things we will be looking at going forward is Scotland-specific modelling of the labour market, and we highlighted that in the report.
And just one final question, if I may. Across the UK, we've seen an increasing move for businesses to incorporate, for people to move away from a position of private employment and perhaps incorporate, therefore moving out of the personal income tax system into the corporate tax system. And I think the Chancellor addressed this in the autumn statement in terms of the differential tax treatment between those two models of business. Do you think that may, because of the fiscal framework, do you think that move towards incorporation may have an impact on the overall income tax take for Scotland?
The
there is an effect in there at the moment. So after the basic forecast and is produced, there are various off-model adjustments, and the two principal ones, I think, are gift aid and incorporations. And there's an assumption in the UK tax forecast, income tax forecast, which has an effect of incorporations, and there's a reflection of that in the Scottish income tax forecast as well. So yeah, that effect is in there at the moment.
Okay.
And it follows a similar profile to the UK.
Okay, thank you.
James, I think you had some questions around the earnings issue as well.
Yeah, I've got some follow-up on that. You've built up this methodology where there's a link between employment, earnings growth and tax levels, and you've explained that there's a difference between public sector wage growth and private sector wage growth, and that the private sector's growing to 4.9 and the public sector remains static at 2.3. What does that then say about employment levels and employment growth in the public and private sectors?
These assumptions, as I said, the 2.2 percent wage growth is the Scottish Government's assumption, and that's based on earnings growth in the public sector in the period, speaking of austerity. So it's meant to capture, it's meant to reflect that the next few years should be a lot like the last few years in terms of overall public sector pay growth. And so then, as Campbell reminded me, the private sector wage growth then comes out as a residual from overall earnings growth in the economy once you take into account that path for public sector earnings growth. What that says about relative employment levels in the private and the public sector, the assumption that drives the model is a forecast for overall employment. You can drill down into the income tax model and presumably get out separate paths for employment in these sectors. The Scottish Government haven't published that, and we've not looked at it. But the key driver of the income tax forecast in terms of employment is overall employment growth.
Right, but you're not able, for example, the forecast for employment growth in 2018-19 is 0.2%, but you're able to differentiate as to the growth in wage levels between public and private sector, but the model is not detailed enough in order to differentiate between employment levels at public and private sector.
I think implicit in the model will be some trajectory for employment in the public and private sector. I've not looked at those detailed breakdowns. And
well, you would agree with the logic that private sector, the figures seem to derive a logic that employment in the private sector is growing at a faster rate than employment in the public sector, and bearing in mind the level of figures, you might actually be seeing a decline in employment in the public sector.
I'm not going to guess at what the underlying model would be implying about relative growth rates. I think you're probably right that the assumption about the public sector is meant to be one, you know, I mean, where, you know, fiscal restraint is driving that whole scenario. So, as I say, what that means about detailed forecasts for overall employment, I don't have an answer or a number for you.
Maybe if I just add to that. So one of the bits of sensitivity analysis we did was to allow private and public sector wages to grow at the same rates and not have this gap between them, and it doesn't make a large difference to the tax forecast. So it's not a material driver of the tax forecast. Implicit in the model, the way the model works is it essentially extrapolates by age group rates of employment. And implicitly, these will be broken down by the private and public sector, but we haven't formally built them back up again to see what the aggregate forecast for these is. But it's not going to be a huge driver of the tax forecast. What's a huge driver of the tax forecast is the aggregate level of employment growth, but more importantly, wage growth.
Right.
You've got some questions in this area as well?
Yeah, just to follow up on that, with the has there been any analysis done of the level of the public sector employment rates related to the level of public sector expenditure? Because obviously the government have put forward their budget, their overall spending plans, so to actually have an analysis of how that will affect public sector employment rates.
Well, no, I mean, the model's focused really on forecasting non-saving, non-dividend liabilities, so that's been very much our focus. You know, if you change these, as Campbell says, if you change the assumptions on the public-private pay split, if you change the assumptions on the employment growth path, if you change the assumptions on earnings paths, does that change radically your forecast for non-saving, non-dividend liabilities? That's been the thing we've been mandated to look at, and so we've kept to that. So we've not really looked at the expenditure side of things that you've mentioned.
Mm-hmm. And just follow up from James Kenneth's question as well, is it possible to get, you know, in terms of the forecast on the actual number of what's been forecast for public sector employment rates for next year?
I think you need to be slightly careful. This is not a model that's built to forecast public sector employment rates. The Scottish Government would need to answer that question, I think, to you rather than us. But I suspect they might say that this is not a model that's been designed to forecast public sector employment rates. That's not what it was designed to do.
But out of the 0.3% that's forecasted to increase, what proportion of that would be public sector growth?
I don't know the answer to that.
I think we'll move on to a different area now in LBTT. But first of all, before I say that, and obviously in terms of your role in future, I think it's quite clear that the committee will need to have the commission back to talk about in future how you're going about the forecasting, etc., because I realise we're not getting much chance to concentrate on how you're going to be taking things forward after this budget. So we'll come back probably into the new financial year, I think, and have another discussion with you at that time to let you tell us a bit more about what your activity is going to be. I'm afraid today's evidence session inevitably is based on what the Scottish Government's going to forecast and has been about. And with that said, we're on probably LBTT now, and I'll take Murdo.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I want to ask some questions about residential lands and buildings transaction tax, which Lady Susan Rice, you alluded to in your opening statement. I see from your report that you state that the estimated outturn for the current financial year is going to be 208 million, which is down 74 million on the forecast, which is a very significant reduction in the originally forecast figures, and I think puts into context the report this committee did on LBTT a few weeks ago. Perhaps even more serious, as you alluded to, you know, there's been a very significant, indeed catastrophic, drop in the forecast for LBTT for the next 3 years, amounting to £833 million, or 46% of the previous forecast total. So, I mean, given there's such a significant drop compared to what was previously forecast, How do we explain this? What's been going on here?
I'll turn to Campbell to give you some of the detail, but as I said before, it's partly due to a change in forecast methodology and also a start point. The LBTT is particularly sensitive to the fact that some remarkable things happened to housing during the early years of the financial crisis, and where you make your start point alters the numbers that come out of the end of the forecast, but Campbell will give you a more technical response.
Okay. The table that essentially does this reconciliation is table 16 on page 45 of the report. So, and what this table does is it essentially starts from the original forecast of 295, which was then downgraded to 282 given the ADS adjustment, and then tries to reconcile that with what we seem to be observing in outturn data at the moment. So the first thing that would lead you lead to the shortfall in the forecast is that the original forecast was starting from 2014-15 outturn data for house prices and transactions and so on. It then forecast these forwards based on a statistical model of average house price growth, which then tended towards long-term averages, which tended to forecast quite robust house price growth. So these two factors gave rise to a fairly buoyant initial forecast. And because of the progressivity of the tax, when house prices are forecast to grow quite strongly, you push more and more transactions into the 325, 750 band, which generates lots and lots of revenues. So it's very highly geared. If you've got a buoyant market, you'll generate lots of revenues. So by the end of the forecast horizon in the previous budget, there was a forecast for residential LBTT, which was quite large, and to a large extent, that was based on transactions being dragged into the 325, 750 bracket. What's happened since then is that the outturn data for 15-16 wasn't as favourable as forecast, and average prices in particular didn't grow as well as median prices, which implies a shift away from the top end of the market. To a large extent, that was due to forestalling. Or could be due to forestalling activity. So that would reduce the forecast to 243 million. So clearly it doesn't go all the way to explaining current outturn numbers. So if we then sequentially replace the price and transactions forecasts from the 16-17 budget with the ones we now have in the 17-18 budget, we progressively drill down to see why the forecast has been revised. And the main thing is that prices in the market, both average and median, haven't grown, aren't forecast to grow as expected, or haven't grown as expected.
Okay, that's fine. That's quite a technical answer, but I think I understand most of it. I suppose my follow-up question is, how does this relate to what's happening elsewhere in the UK? Now, I know that forecasts have been reduced for stamp duty land tax in the rest of the UK, but not to the same extent. So can you talk a little bit about how what's happening in Scotland relates to what's happening in the UK, and therefore what therefore is the knock-on effect through the fiscal framework on the Scottish finances?
Well, our remit is to analyse kind of residential LBTT in Scotland and not SDLT in the rest of the UK, so we haven't focused on that at all. Observations I could make off the top of my head are that the residential LBTT in Scotland is relatively more progressive than in the rest of the UK, so it's going to be more geared towards changes in forecasts for house prices. At the same time, I think the OBR's forecasts for the housing market in the rest of the UK are slightly more buoyant than the Scottish Government is currently forecasting, given its new methodology. So those combinations of factors may explain the difference.
In the London the market can often drive the UK forecast.
And in terms of the fiscal framework, the differential in tax take or projected tax take between LBTT and stamp duty land tax elsewhere in the UK, what impact does that have on the money that's coming to the Scottish Government?
We haven't focused on block grant adjustments or the SDLT forecast revenues. Our remit is to focus on LBTT revenues.
Okay.
Okay, Mordor.
Thank you.
Ivan?
Thanks, panel. I just want to explore that whole area a wee bit more detail. Clearly there's a disconnect between the forecast last year and the forecast that we've got this year. And reading through basically on section 5 of your big report, you're basically saying the model's fine, but the issue is round about the forecast of the economic determinants. And as you unpick that in table 16, it kind of explains what's going on there. And then you drill down further into that and you're talking about the key issues, the mean and the median being out of kilter rather than the number of transactions. When you break that down, the biggest impact is driven by the mean and the median being off compared to forecast.
Yes, well, so in 15-16, the mean and median were both subdued relative to forecast, but the mean was relatively more subdued. This year, both are subdued relative to forecast, but there's no obvious additional kind of shift in the mean relative to the median. They both seem to be growing relatively slowly.
But the issue on transaction numbers isn't the main issue.
Yeah.
And we've seen that also in the analysis we did earlier in terms of the trends in transactions.
Yes, so the key driver for revenues, this tax, 60% of the revenues are generated by the 325, 750 tax band. So whenever you have a buoyant market, you push more into that band, and that generates more revenues.
Right.
If that doesn't happen, revenues don't materialise.
Got it.
Can I just make sure I understand that, Ivan? Sorry. So the number of transactions in the 325, 750 bracket area, compared with the rest of the market, really didn't shift that much.
So the 325, 750 band has a relatively small proportion of transactions. Less than 10% of transactions are in that band, but it generates over 60% of revenues. So if you look back at the kind of buoyant forecasts in the last budget, these were driven by an increasing share of transactions going to the 325, 750 band. So I think it was, you know, to get that those large revenues in, you would have to go above 10% share of transactions going to that tax band. That hasn't quite materialised.
Okay. Sorry, Ivan. Apologies.
Yeah. So just going to talk about the bands then. So we've established that there isn't an issue with the number of transactions. If you look at the bands, clearly when the changes were made to introduce LBTT, at the lower end, it was made more favourable, it was made cheaper, tax was lowered, and it was increased at the higher end. And you can see that in the shape of your log normal. So if there was an issue round about the higher tax driving down the number of transactions at the higher end, we've already seen the number of transactions hasn't changed, then you would have seen a differential impact across the bands. But whereas if you actually look at what you've got, if I'm reading this right, tables 18 and 19 and 5.22, when you decompose all of that, the reality is that for all the bands up to 750, there's basically the same drop-off in terms of the number of transactions. So what that says is there hasn't been a differential impact as a consequence of the increase in LBTT in the 325 to 750 range. In actual fact, if you look at what's happened in the 750 plus and the 1 million plus, they're actually performed significantly better than forecast based on that log normal you originally used. Is that true to say?
So in the 15-16 outturns, which I think we discussed in our previous outturn report, there was some evidence that in the 325-750 bands, there was a clear episode of forestalling, but it might have persisted. The relatively low performance of that band might have persisted throughout the year, and there's various reasons why that might be the case. For the 16-17 outturn numbers that we have so far, it looks as though both mean and median prices haven't been growing as expected, so there's been no tilting away from that particular band. So in proportional terms, the forecast errors common across the top three bands, or bottom three bands, but because the 325, 750 band accounts for most of the revenues, that's where most of the forecast error shows up.
Absolutely not true to say that that's caused by, there's not been any change in the shape of the, and you actually say yourself, no major change in the shape of the distribution.
In the 16-17 right. outturn data that we have today,
right.
so that's correct.
Whereas if the higher tax rate was driving a behavioural change in that range, we would have seen a change in that distribution.
Well, it could be that you observed the change in 15-16 and it's persisted into 16-17.
Okay. Yeah. And you also talk about misallocation between the top bands, which kind of ties in because clearly in the higher rate above 750, you've actually seen a strengthening of the market.
Yeah, so that relates to the fact that even if you put in the outturn economic determinants, the model in aggregate forecasts quite well, but particularly amongst the top two bands, it kind of overpredicts the revenues you get from 325 and underpredicts the revenues you seem to get from the above 750 band.
Mm-hmm.
If you then account for that using what we observed in 15-16, it doesn't make a huge impact on aggregate revenues, and it makes a bit of an adjustment to what you would observe in the 325-750 band plus the top band, but it's about a 5% adjustment
okay.
in that 325-750 band, so it's not a huge effect.
Not huge, okay. The other impact that's obviously causing something to happen in here is this Aberdeen effect, which you talk about, table 22, 5.27, and you're saying that accounts for the balance of the difference of the stuff you haven't found, because clearly the Aberdeen Aberdeenshire market is way off the pace as a consequence of the oil impact up there.
So I think we kind of present this as being a highly speculative thought experiment. So what we do in this particular case is we don't actually have revenue outturn data for the Aberdeen City or the Aberdeen area. So one of the things we hope to do when meeting Revenue Scotland in the new year is to look at ways of whether we can actually obtain this data. So what we're instead doing is we're saying, well, here's the state of the Aberdeen housing market in 1415. Here was the forecast for Scottish house prices that was made in the previous budget. Let's extrapolate that. Let's imagine that Aberdeen was expected to grow in line with the forecast for the Scottish economy as a whole. What revenues would that be expected to generate? And then looking at how the Aberdeen housing market has actually performed, what revenues would that be expected to generate? And we look at the difference. And that difference can account for about half of the forecast error this year. But it's a highly speculative exercise. Okay. We don't know if the model fits Aberdeen or not.
So okay. Could I just sort of re-emphasize that point, that the question we started with was, are there regional differences here? And then from that question, where might we look? Well, Aberdeen seemed, because of what we're seeing about housing activity there, Aberdeen seemed like a likely place to take a look. That's all that this is, but we don't really have the evidence behind this yet. But it's the kind of exploration we might do in the future.
You do have is a calculation, and understand those caveats, but you do have a calculation that does give a number that goes a long way to explaining what was left of any drop-off in your forecast.
Yeah, I think the last meeting we came to, we said we would come at the data from any angle we could to try and see what's explaining it. Okay. This is one of the angles.
So what I'm hearing is then there's a number of reasons why we're off against the forecast, but none of them are anything to do with the fact that there's higher tax rates at the top end of the market. Can we talk a wee bit now about the sensitivity analysis?
That's your leading
witness. Well, I didn't. I gave you plenty of opportunity to say that, and we talked about Aberdeen, we talked about the median, we talked about number of transactions.
Right. Well, I think I said there was a shift from average relative to median in 15-16, which appears to have not worsened but has persisted into this year. Right. That could be a behavioural response.
Okay.
Right. Last question.
Clearly, going forward then, because clearly there's been a disconnect there. Do you want to just talk around about the sensitivity analysis you've done? Because clearly we don't want to be in the same position next year that we are this year in terms of being significantly off against the forecast.
So the Scottish Government has adjusted its way it forecasts the economic determinants this year. So in previous budgets, it's essentially had a small statistical model to forecast average house prices, which it then kind of pasted onto an assumption that house prices would grow in line with some long-term average. They then assumed that median prices would grow alongside average prices in the same way, and that transactions would tend towards some long-run turnover rate. Now, following our recommendations, they've adopted statistical models for each one of these elements individually. They've also attempted to differentiate between what was happening before the financial crisis and what's been happening after the financial crisis. So where the previous forecasts tended to go to long-run averages, which included the fairly buoyant period before the financial crisis, the current forecasts tend to extrapolate to a greater extent the behaviour or the performance of the market we've observed post-financial crisis. And this tends to lead to a far more subdued forecast. So what we did is, I mean, we're looking at the same data, we're looking at the same types of models, but we made little changes to assumptions about how you would model things. Instead of using one type of statistical model, we used another. Instead of looking at the turnover ratio, we looked at the rate of growth of transactions. Instead of looking at the ratio of median to mean prices, we looked at the rate of growth of median prices. We see what forecasts they would throw out. We see whether or not the forecast would be materially affected by changing any of these elements. And the conclusion we reach is average and median prices are the key driver of these forecasts. That's the thing you need to get right to forecast accurately. But the various bits of analysis that we threw at it suggest that the Scottish Government's forecasts were reasonable. We couldn't find an obviously better way of doing things.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Right, okay, we'll bore down to a fair bit of detail in this discussion today. I did say to the clerk that's a lot of detail, and his response to me in the ever positive way is good for the report. So we're very grateful for you coming along today, for giving us this evidence session. I'm sure that those from the SFT are now looking forward to the same level of detail we were sitting behind you about to be enter into the next set of witnesses. But in the meantime, I suspend the meeting for a very short space of time just to allow a change of witnesses. And again, thank you very much for coming along, and hope you have a good Christmas and a good New Year. Thank you.
Thank you, and good wishes for Christmas to you all. Okay, colleagues, we reconvene. The third item on our agenda today is to take evidence from the Scottish Futures Trust as part of our scrutiny of the draft budget for 2017-18. And we're joined in this session by Barry White, the Chief Executive of the Trust, and Peter Reakey, who's the Director of Investment. I welcome
both of our witnesses to the meeting, and I just wonder if Barry White wants to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to be here today. Before we make that statement, just to, as we did last year, to register a number of interests, we don't think there's any conflict, but nevertheless, just to be clear, I'm the public interest director on the M8 project company. Peter is the project director, public interest director on the AWPR project company. And we both hold two charitable appointments, one being Peter in the Community Hub Foundation charity and me in the Lahr Housing Trust. And these are all roles that SFT have asked us to fulfil. So, and nor are they paid directly in any way to us. So it's not a personal thing. It's something we represent the public sector on. So I just probably wanted to do that first of all. We've provided a written document which highlights elements of our work, and we included a section around the call for evidence last year in our work and some helpful suggestions people made, and we have responded to that, and we hope that's useful to the committee. Last gave evidence in Pitlochry on the 18th of January this year, and during that session we gave evidence on the impact of changing the European accounting rules across the NPD and Hub programmes. And we had just at that stage just reached financial close in Air Academy under the Hub programme, which was something that we were very pleased to be able to get done quickly after we'd been given the go-ahead from ONS under the restructuring of the Hub programme. Since then, ONS has confirmed, as we indicated, it was likely in our evidence, that the other NPD projects reaching financial close after ESA 10 was introduced will be publicly classified. That's the AWPR, which was already known about, the Edinburgh Sick Children's Hospital, Dumfries and Galloway Royal Infirmary, and the Blood Transfusion Centre, New National Centre, Blood Transfusion Service. And the combined capital value of these projects is around £930 million. Also, since then, we appeared in front of the committee. There's been two further updates to the guidance affecting ESA 10, and which now is believed to have brought a much more stable position for ESA 10 classification going forward. It's almost 2 years after being introduced, and after many iterations of guidance, two since January. And through that changing period of time, and since the start of this year, we with our partners have now closed 18 hub contracts for schools and community health investments, totalling around £600 million since the start of this year. And this positions as one of the top three countries in Europe for additional investment. Two other things I'd like to add very quickly. We're very pleased that one of our traditionally funded projects in Hub has trialled the Project Bank Account initiative, which was formally introduced by government in October this year. And I know for smaller businesses in the construction sector, being paid promptly is a key issue. And Project Bank Accounts don't solve that issue entirely, but it's a useful step forward in smoothing the payment process. I know the Federation of Small Businesses feel very strongly about that. We've also seen significant progress in growth accelerator financing, and Dundee just signed this month. And those of you who know Edinburgh will see the great progress being made on the demolition of the St James Centre, which was catalysed by the Edinburgh Growth Accelerator deal. I think the increasing dynamism and confidence in Scotland's cities is a very positive feature, and is actually one that's all the more important as Scotland's public services become more reliant on income from the Scottish economy. And one thing within the construction industry at the moment is people are talking about Brexit, and there's a Shepherd and Wedderburn report recently highlighted that there's a concern about workforce in particular, and that industry relies on foreign skilled and non-skilled workforce. And within the construction sector, 22% of current workers are over 50, and 15% are over 60. So actually, there is a concern about workforce going forward. I think, unfortunately, I count as one of the 22% over 50, rather than the 15% over 60. So I never thought of myself as being an aged worker, but according to this Shepherd and Wedderburn article, that would appear to be the case.
Makes me feel great.
very happy to take questions about our work or about anything to do with the 17-18 draft budget.
I would like to get some stuff on the record today, if I can, about the whole issue around ESA 10. And obviously that first came out in September 2014, and a number of NDB projects, as you've already described, had to be classified as on balance sheet. But in your written material to us, you provide on page 5, you describe the actions taken by SFT and the Scottish Government since September 2014 to refocus activity, to use that, if that's the right terminology, in the light of the ESA 10. Can you just give us a bit more detail of what that actually meant, and to try to make sure that not as many of the projects were, as could have been the case, were classified as on balance sheet? I think that would be helpful just for the purposes of the record.
Okay, and I might ask Peter to come in specifically on the restructuring of the hub process, but across Europe, people were having to deal with a complex set of rules that were changing, and that has affected a number of organisations, not least more recently housing associations coming on balance sheet as well. Network Rail being another example, and the schools aggregator at in UK level. And even a year after ESA 10 was introduced in September 15, the European PPP Expertise Centre, which is hosted by the European Investment Bank, at a presentation in Flanders, said that ESA 10 was a moving target with a continuous addition of interpretations, and that there's a hardening of Eurostat rules and interpretation and increasing importance of case opinions. So really what's happened in the 2 years since ESA 10 was introduced up to September 16 was a number of projects have been scrutinised by classification bodies across Europe, and that has emerged then with much clearer guidance in September this year. So I'll ask Peter to comment on Hub DBFM restructuring. So what that means going forward is in structuring standalone projects, again, PD projects were procured on a standalone basis, there is much clearer guidance now about how that could be done going forward. And I think across Europe, that is very much appreciated. And, you know, Allianz, who gave evidence to the committee in writing last year as part of the call for evidence about SFT, said that, you know, this was having an effect sort of stalling projects across Europe. So that's where we are in terms of where the guidance now sits. It's now much clearer and much more stable going forward. The one challenging issue is if you were to do a business case for a new project now, it'd probably take about a year to get a new business case done and potentially 18 months to procure it. So actually, to start a new project now, we would need to be clear on what the UK government's intention was going to be in the run-up to Brexit or post-Brexit, ignoring the politics of Brexit and so on, but just practically we would need to know where or what the intention would be for the rules post-March 19, if that is to be the date at which the UK would leave the European Union. Now, the belief would be those would be very much in line with the current Eurostat rules. There would need to be a set of rules of some sort. Others are suggesting that would be a chance for the UK to do something different. So for just looking forward for a minute, you know, ESA 10 is stabilised, but actually it's stabilised within a time window that's limited then by... Now, perhaps we can get reassurance from ONS and Treasury, and we will have those discussions on what is the likely regime beyond that. Peter, do you want to talk about the work we did in terms of restructuring Hub?
Yes, certainly. The Hub programme is a partnership arrangement between the public and the private sectors that operates in 5 separate territories across Scotland and is there to develop community infrastructure. So lots of schools and health centres are built through that programme, and they can be funded either through traditional capital budgets or through long-term revenue budgets under design, build, finance and maintain, or DBFM route. Those DBFM projects are affected by the classification rules ESA 10, And we spent a lot of time in 2015 restructuring the nature of that partnership between the public and private sectors to retain a private classification for these projects and allow us to pay out of long-term revenue budgets with the change in rules. And the main change that we made to allow that to happen was the introduction of a charity, the Hub Community Foundation, as a 20% shareholder in the individual project companies that take forward those projects. And that allows 20% ownership to be there and the returns from that ownership to be there for the public good without being classified to the public sector for national accounts purposes. And the public sector ownership has reduced down to 20%, with 60% retained in the private sector, as has always been the case. So it originally started off as 60% private, 40% public. It's now 60% private, 20% charity, and 20% public. So that restructuring has allowed us to maintain the balance between private profit and public good, but to allow us to retain a private classification in the new rules. And that was allowed John Swinney to make a statement in November 2015 that these projects could go ahead. And since then, as Barry said, we've closed 18 projects. Within that period, since the turn of this year, there was a further revision to the European guidance in March, which required us to do some very small changes to the contract documentation, but not to the overall structure. And again, as Barry alluded to, there were further changes in September, which again have required us to make some small changes to the contract documentation, but not to the overall structure. And through those two further changes, we've managed to maintain the pace of all the projects. So we closed 8 projects under the 2014 guidance, another 7 under the 2016 guidance, and another 3 under the September guidance this year. So we've had to work very quickly with all of our public and private sector partners to allow those projects to go ahead in quite a rapidly changing arena of guidance, as Barry said, which we hope is now stable and will allow these projects and the additionality that comes from them, over 600 million now additional investment, to keep going through the Hub programme into the future.
And these 18 projects, in terms of the public sector element of the expenditure, what would that amount to? Well, if you've got off the top of your head, it would be something.
So, had those all been classified to the public sector, then over 600 million would have counted against current capital budgets in this year and probably next year as they're built over a period of 2 years, and that is now not the case because we've retained the private sector classification, and they can be paid for out of revenue budgets over the life as they're used.
I was keen to get that on the record because it shows, I think, you've been fleet of foot in terms of trying to deal with the issues and challenges you've had, and you know, effectively secured that additional amount of expenditure that would have been hitting on to capital project costs. So, Marie, I think you maybe had a question around capital stuff as well, am I right?
I just really wanted to confirm that when we're looking at the spend for capital projects, it might be a very simple question, forgive me, but it's a lot bumpier and less predictable and fluctuates a great deal more than, say, revenue spend. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So it's almost impossible to make assumptions. So when we look back at what's happened, there's been a delay in some projects, hasn't there? In terms of some projects had to be delayed because of the change in classification. Yeah.
Here
again, you want to?
Yeah. So there were a number of projects in the Hub programme that were put on pause during late 2015, and those are the ones that were caught up in the first quarter of 2016, where we most of the 18 projects were closed in the first quarter as we managed to get them going again. Yeah.
And they're all, nothing has not happened because of the change in accounting rules.
That's right. The programme, all of the projects that were in the Hub pipeline have continued and are now in construction that had faced that small delay. Yeah.
So all we see is a slightly different pattern.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Dean, I think you had some questions around classification issues as well.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for your paper and explanation of the background to ESA 10. My understanding is the trigger to bring these projects on balance sheet was the degree of public control over the project or the SPV controlling the project. With the restructuring to bring about a private classification, can you explain what level of public control is still in place over these projects and how you have managed to achieve that level of public control without obviously bringing it back on balance sheet?
Again, I might ask Peter to talk to some of the specifics around that, but you know, all of our projects have a director on the board, and that is still the case. So from a point of view of one of the key things in terms of transparency, which I think is a big change in these projects, and I think something very helpful for how these are managed, that continues to be the case. Peter, do you want to talk about some of the... Yeah.
There's two main ways that we get control of what happens in these projects. The first and most important is through the contract that says that the company that's established to deliver the project must deliver a project in the following way, in the following time, and it will be paid the following amount of money, and it must maintain it to the right standards. That contract and the way that those standards are specified and the way that the payments are made are largely unchanged through all of this. So that's the way under any building contract you would say, I want this, I will pay you for that if it's done in the right way. Because project companies were set up for this sort of project, we also had some corporate controls over that company. And some of those corporate controls have been relaxed in the way that the board works. So we now have, as Barry said, the transparency through having the board director in place, but we're not able to do some things that previously we thought would be a great idea. And like, for example, stopping the company changing its name and things like that come through the company's own constitution. Less important than the overall control that you get through the contract, but the classifiers were particularly keen on the control of the project company, and that's where we've had to make some changes.
Thank you. Just in terms of the public sector shareholding has dropped to 20%, is that right? Does that mean you still have to have a pro rata share on the balance sheet, 20% of the project cost or capital spend on the balance sheet, or is it all or nothing? Since it's now deemed as private classification, is all of it now off balance sheet?
So this is where things get a little bit tricky in the difference between budgeting and accounting. The goal of all of this, in a way, was to allow long-term revenue budgets to be allowed to pay for these buildings rather than capital del budgets as they're constructed. So these rules, the European accounting rules and statistical treatments, are what's relevant in the UK context for budgeting. Every individual body that procures one of these assets will account under IFRS standards. So the way the projects are accounted for is different from the way they're budgeted for. In budgeting terms, it will all be from long-term revenue budgets, whereas in accounting terms, it's likely that on the books of one of the health boards, for example, you would see that asset because they have both a contract for it and an interest in the project. So the goal was a budgeting goal, and that's what's been achieved.
Clarify that is a UK level. So the national accounts with ONS are the ones that align with budgets, yeah. And the IFRS accounts are sort of, I think, what are used for the whole of government accounts. Yeah. So it's just a different two different purposes for two different sets of accounts.
Yeah. And just going back to your point about Brexit, Brexit would impact on EAS 20, but it wouldn't impact on the IFRS treatment because, notwithstanding Brexit, IFRS would still apply within the UK to the ONS for accounting purposes?
I think the question for the ONS and Treasury going forward as part of what to do post-Brexit will be to decide how do we do our national accounts,
because we'll still have to declare national accounts that will be scrutinised by people who want to lend the UK money or whatever else. So ESA 10 is underpinned by a UN accounting system. Mm. So anything we do will probably be underpinned by that same accounting system, but whether we choose to keep ESA 10 broadly or whether we choose to do something different, it'll be a decision to be made by the UK government. Okay. And the ONS would become, I presume, the ultimate arbiter in terms of classification, because we would be no longer subject, again, I imagine, to Eurostat.
Sorry, one final question. Any further changes expected to this accounting standard, or do you think you're now at the final point?
Eurostat have said that they hope this final change, which is quite a substantial rewrite that has involved PPP experts from the European Investment Bank and is therefore much more easy to interpret by practitioners. They've said that they intend that to be stable for a period of time, although they, of course, reserve the right to make changes should they see that as necessary.
Good, thank you.
I've started to hear running in this area because four folk want to ask supplementaries on it. So forgive me if we don't get into some of the other details of your the areas of your excellent report you gave us. But James.
Okay, thanks, Convener. You described a situation where there was a tranche of 18 projects and you were able to classify those at least partly as publicly, and that allowed you to smooth the kind of expenditure against revenue budgets over a period of time. Can I ask about the four projects which which have had to be classified publicly? And you said at the start, Mr. White, that the financial total for that was £930 million. What's the budgetary implications of that?
I think the budgetary implication I can comment on, but it's really the detail that's more a matter for the government, because how they decide to budget for it. I believe that there's a letter to the Finance Committee for 15-16 setting out that £283 million of borrowing powers had been used to cover that for 15-16. And I believe for 16-17, the final decision on how that's going to be covered will be taken later in the year. So I think, from my knowledge, that's what we believe to be the case. But we supply the information to government and they will decide the precise budgeting of it.
I'm not really clear as to, you mentioned at the start as a figure of £930 million, and there have been reports in the media that that means £930 million of money lost to the Scottish budget. I'm not endorsing those reports, but I'm anxious to try and establish the facts of the matter. How is that £930 million had to be dealt with in terms of the Scottish Government budget? As a result of these new accounting rules?
So the cost of that 930 was spread over a number of years. So if we take 15-16 and just expand on that example a little bit further, in 15-16 there was about £400 million worth of investment that was off balance sheet, and there was about £283 million from the projects we've talked about, the four that are on balance sheet. And there was an agreement between Treasury and the Scottish Government, again, that with a letter to the Finance Committee explaining that £283 million of borrowing powers had been agreed with Treasury to use borrowing powers to cover that £283 million. So in that year, that's how that was dealt with in that year. In the year ahead, in 17-18, the four projects require that are on balance sheet, the NPD ones that are on balance sheet, have £190 million, roughly, of that are on balance sheet. And again, the Scottish Government will decide through the year, as I understand. And again, I'm getting bits where I'm saying, it's not for me to say what the Scottish Government, but they will again liaise with Treasury and decide what is the most effective way of doing that. So actually, but So the 1 year, 15-16, I've talked about is it. The effect of that was to use up some of the government's borrowing powers.
Is the impact of this, you describe the situation where you're a tranche 18 projects and you were able to revenue fund them over a period of years, is the effect of this that you're having to bring on more of the expenditure earlier? Is that the impact?
So again, back to 15-16, which is the one where Mr. Swinney has written to the Finance Committee on, and again, I think the precise details of how the mechanics of this is really much more for Scottish Government to say, but by using borrowing powers, there would be a mechanism to pay that over time rather than up front, because it's instead of borrowing from the National Loans Fund, now the precise details and agreement between Scottish Government and Treasury, I don't know, but it still has the effect of spreading the cost over time, as I understand it.
I understand from the clerks that this letter may have come in March, before obviously this existing committee came into being. It was the 4th of March, so we'll make sure that's circulated round everybody, James, somebody can see that. But I think there are questions in here we need to ask the Scottish Government to get a clearer perspective from their end about how they're bringing these things into book and the impact. But for these guys, though, I think it's
a bit... Appreciate the witnesses have done their best to try and answer the questions, but certainly from my point of view, I'm not clear about this area.
Well, we need to make it clear. We need to make it clear. I accept that. Patrick.
Thank you. Good morning. Can I apologise in advance if this is a bit of a daft laddie question? Because, Mr. Rickey... expressed the purpose of these kind of arrangements as being avoiding the need for upfront capital expenditure by the Scottish Government and being able to move things onto longer term revenue budgets. Now, if everything else was equal, that might be all very well. But figures that we've seen under FOI show that we're actually paying significantly higher interest rates than we would be paying under the National Loans Fund. In one case, more than 11%. Compared with 1.6%. And we've also seen that public sector bodies like the NHS are paying, in some cases, three times what labour costs actually are to have contractors undertake work. Contractors charging three times for electrical work, what it costs per hour for an electrician to get their wages paid. Why does it cost so much more to do things this way?
Certainly not a daft laddie question. So, I presume this is referring to the article in The Guardian that had some of these figures in it. Taking the cost of finance first, it's clearly different if you're borrowing as a government on a risk-free basis, i.e. you, the borrower, must just pay back regardless, or if you're borrowing money and transferring risk at the same time. So in comparing costs of finance, there's a big difference between the two. The cost of senior debt in these projects, which is the bulk of the finance going into them, the particular article got wrong, and actually it's closer to 3.5%, or around 3.5% is the cost of senior debt in the project. Now, at that level, yes, that is more expensive than the National Loans Fund was at that time, but is actually under the long-term average for the National Loans Fund for long-term borrowing, and is also under the pooled rate at which local government would assess borrowing. So local government, a lot of the pooled rates in local government are around 5%, I believe. So the cost of finance secured in these deals is much more competitive than the long-term average for borrowing, and much more competitive than the historic PFI deals that were secured at much higher cost of finance. So
it's we're talking about lower interest rates than the early PFI schemes, but still you would have to accept significantly higher than public sector borrowing.
Yes. So there's a, for transferring risk to the private sector and bringing in private sector finance to bear risk, you will pay an additional premium. And that is the risk, in effect, you're transferring, is that you don't have to pay for that asset unless it is properly maintained and looked after. And there's a very strong contract in place to say this must be looked after properly for its whole life or for 25 years. And I think that's actually a really important element, because, you know, that longevity of making sure something is properly maintained is actually a key aspect of how do you stop spending that money again in 25 years' time, and maintaining properly is part of that. I think also there's actually a big task for us all in the public sector to look at how we're managing the existing contracts, the historical ones, because I do believe there's work to be done to actually improve the performance standard of those older contracts under PPP and PFI. And we have a team of people deployed to do that, working with health boards and local authorities that are making a good inroad into it, but there's more work to be done in that.
And on the point about the public sector paying significantly more, in some cases three times as much, to have trades carried out than the tradespeople themselves are being paid.
And I think NHS Lothian commented on that particular bit in the article and said that along the lines of, you know, a figure that doesn't include national insurance or the cost of employment, or so you don't. I don't think any of us get somebody turning up at our house to work at that. You know, if you employ a plumber at your house, you don't pay. You don't pay the rate that was set out in that article, if you know what I mean, in terms of the bare hourly rate.
And the cost of employment would be a factor of three.
I could come back to you on the specific figures. I would need to go and have a look at them to come back to you on the specific figures. But I think it is a rate for a tradesman on site rather than simply a reflection of purely the hourly rate. And in general, you would see when people are quoting for work, that is what you would see.
Well, if you could come back with any more detailed answers on these matters, I think it'd be helpful. Yeah. I think if people are going to have any confidence that the public sector is getting good value for money, then I think some of these questions do need to be answered in more detail.
And maybe just offer some more other information is that the one of the changes that has been made over the years is that by having a pre-price schedule, it's assessed before contract signature. Say if we do have these small changes, we want to avoid some of the exorbitant costs of the past. So the pre-price schedule is there to actually manage some of the excesses of the past. So
do you produce for any one of these kind of projects, do you produce an overall figure or even an estimate about the proportion of what the public sector spends over the lifetime of the project that will be profit for the companies involved?
Well, I think what we do publish is there's a number of things we do publish. We publish a clear flow of unitary charges as deals are signed on the government's website. And in all the contracts, we've moved to a presumption of publication after 3 years, Peter, is it?
2 years post construction completion.
2 years post construction completion. So we've actually moved onto a much more transparent basis where the presumption is on publication 2 years after the facilities open. So actually the details precisely of how these models work will be available on each of these projects as and when that date happens.
What doesn't tend to be the case, and I don't think it's the case in any sort of procurement, is that, or fixed price procurement, is that the construction contractor or the facilities management contractor as a company don't tend to have to declare at an individual project level whether they made profits or losses on individual projects. And most of the activity done under these contracts is the same as the activity done under individual standalone construction or facilities management contracts. So that tends to be a matter for the individual company when it fixes a price for a contract, whether it makes a profit or a loss on that.
Patrick, I'll let that go on a bit, but we're beginning to stray away a fair bit from actual budget scrutiny. So, and we've got quite a bit of stuff in here around whether it's SFT Invest, SFT Home, SFT Place, SFT Green, we're not going to get to. So forgive me for that, but I've still got a number of colleagues who want to come in. Can we make sure, from now on in, we can keep it as tightly to the budget as we can, folks, because this is the last chance we get to before we get to budget issues with the Minister in the new year. So, Ivan?
Yeah, no, I'm very, very brief, because Patrick's covered a lot of what I was going to cover. And my question was really just about the reason why we do this. My understanding is we do it because it keeps the debt-to-GDP ratio at a level that's acceptable to the markets. Is that basically the bottom line? Well, in the context of the Scottish Government, clearly there are borrowing limits, but in the context of the wider Treasury.
It's a fascinating question, because, yes, a simple answer would be yes, but because all this is published anyway, the ratings agencies will look at the other liabilities the UK government has as a whole. So even though it's off balance sheet, because it's public information, okay, they will add that liability, and they'll also look at the pension liabilities of the country. You know, so the ratings agencies look at the whole picture when they're looking at.
So it really should come down to the stuff Patrick was talking about around what's the cheapest way to do it, and that's something we're not going to get into here, but probably something we want to look at as a finance committee at some future stage.
We can come back and do this stuff in greater detail if we wish as a committee later on. But Marie.
I had a very quick supplementary in terms of, you were very clear about Brexit probably having an impact on infrastructure projects in terms of it's a 2.5 year run-in between the idea and the project actually happening, business case plus procurement. Brexit is likely to happen in less than 2.5 years, and I, as I understood it, you said it is likely to cause a pause in the same way as no.
I wouldn't say. I think if we, for instance, what we're really saying is if we wanted to do more project financed infrastructure in Scotland, starting to do it now, the ESA 10 rules are much more stable, but we would need to agree with the UK government what they thought the regime would be in 2.5 years' time. And if they could tell us that now, then that would give us stability looking forward. And I think in the whole Brexit debate, this is a, you know, it's a very granular bit, but for the particular bit we're looking at, it would be important to know what the intention of the UK government would be. Okay. So it's not having an immediate impact because the government hasn't, there's no projects waiting to happen through project finance that aren't happening. But in terms of if we wanted to do more this way, on top of the 450 million borrowing powers going forward, then I think that would be something we would have to address with the UK government and the Office of National Statistics.
Okay,
in the slow-moving world of infrastructure projects, any fast-moving rule change has the potential to disrupt things.
Okay, thank you.
Willie.
Thank you very much, Convener. It was just to pick up on the part in your paper on the digital infrastructure investment and how you see the relationship with the UK developing, particularly in relation to mobile coverage and also with the European Union. I mean, we know that the European Union has a fairly extensive and developed digital single market strategy and agenda, one part of which is removing roaming charges, which will disappear next year. It would be ridiculous in my view that when that happens, then when the UK leaves the European Union, that we take back control and have our own roaming charges again in 2019. So in that sense, I would imagine we will stay within the digital single market, certainly, if not the single market. So how do you see the relationships developing post-Brexit, particularly with digital infrastructure investment?
I think if we talk about the UK relationship first, and one of the most important relationships we have is with Ofcom, and a lot of what happens in Scotland, and because most of the investment in digital comes from the private sector, comes from fixed and mobile operators investing in that infrastructure. And I think there are a number of key issues with Ofcom. We put a submission along with the Scottish Government around the digital review and a digital communications review that suggested what they're now doing with Openreach by putting at arm's length from the rest of BT is probably, that was our view was, in the medium term, that's the most workable solution to try to improve broadband rollout in Scotland. And that actually has an impact on mobile as well, because without having the fibre around the countryside to plug in mobile masts into, then you don't, you know, the connectivity requires that as part of it. The second bit then is about mobile connectivity, and I think there's a number of things happening. First of all, as 5G is introduced, how that's introduced at a UK level and how it's regulated in terms of coverage, because with each iteration, I think the coverage in terms of geographical coverage as well as population coverage has improved a bit. And actually, as a new regime is introduced, the geographical coverage, I think, becomes really important, particularly for Scotland's remote areas. What we're doing at the moment is working with the mobile operators, the Home Office Emergency Service contract that is putting a 4G network, or has got a contract to put a 4G network in place for the emergency services that should cover all the major road networks in rural Scotland, to actually build up a map of where mobile communications are unlikely to go with either the market or with the Home Office rollout, and therefore saying where does the government might need to do something to get that more comprehensive coverage in the more remote communities. But come back to the starting point, and I'll ask Peter to comment on the European side. Back to the starting point, it is the regulation at UK level, I think, is the most important dynamic for how Scotland's coverage and speed of communication and digital is improved and being more accessible.
Yeah, really just to say that we in SFT are not involved in the consumer marketplace for mobile communications. We're involved in thinking about the infrastructure that's required to allow that all to happen. And there is a very big potential economic gain for Scotland in becoming world class in our digital, not just in our digital infrastructure, but our use of digital. And the infrastructure elements that will support that will be things like fibre, as Barry's talked about, power to masts, ducts, and the way we tax and have business rates on the ducts and how we allow those to be owned and operated. Internet exchanges, which is another topic at the moment. The spectrum and how that's managed, which is a UK thing, as we know, and the masts themselves. So all of those hard elements of delivering the service are the bits that we do and then tend to be UK or Scottish controlled, the overall European market. We're not so involved in that.
Maybe just to give a simple example, there's a review in business rates and on domestic rates at the moment, and we have fed into that review that if we attach business rates to what's called dark fibre, so if people put fibre in and put unused fibre in as they lay one stretch of fibre, if you put two or three bits in at the same time but don't use it immediately, if you attach business rates to that, the likelihood of them putting unused capacity in is actually much less, whereas actually we really think it's probably quite a good idea if people are putting a pipe in, they put a bigger pipe in when they're putting it in, even if they don't need all that capacity immediately. So I think there's a series of things we can do in Scotland that help incentivize the private sector to invest in sort of infrastructure that's needed to build that bigger picture. In terms of the EU and roaming, we don't really have a locus. Personally, I think the EU roaming has been great progress, and actually the cost of phone calls as you move in Europe is so much less now than it used to be. And that roaming bid, I think it would be a shame to lose that. But I think that may well rely on, I don't know, who knows what will happen in that.
Did you want a question?
Yeah, sorry. You've talked about Brexit, you've talked about risks, and obviously in terms of financing projects, interest rates are pretty fundamental to borrowing. To what extent do you think that there will be a risk of interest rates going up over the next year to control inflation? And what would be the impact on the budget of an increase in interest rates?
Peter, do you want to?
We're in a world of fairly uncertain and quite rapidly changing interest rates at the minute. So we've had some projects that have been financed on very good terms since the Brexit decision was made, because the long-term rates have gone down and are now at a very, very low level. They've bounced up a bit again since then. What we do for the long-term affordability of the programme is where projects don't have their long-term interest rate locked in, which happens on the day of the financial close, we include quite a significant buffer to allow for the potential for rates to go up, because they're much more likely from where they are now to go up than they are to go down. So all of our long-term affordability modelling that feeds into the government's overall affordability modelling includes a margin for the potential for interest rates to go up. And if we keep locking them in at these low levels, we'll keep seeing the actual affordability be better than what we have predicted.
Ash? Sorry.
I think that's the important point, is that the assumption we made in the programme about interest rates, we are well beneath where, you know, the interest rates now are well beneath the assumption at the outset. And the interest rates, while the Bank of England rate has stayed very static and the American rates have moved up a bit, the market rate for 2025-year debt has been moving up and down, even though those other rates have stayed static. But at the moment, affordability is good, and actually getting these projects done in the early part of this year at low rates has been a fantastic opportunity to lock in that low cost for the next 25 years.
Ash?
I'm just interested in asking you a little bit about SFT Invest, so the Growth Accelerator Scheme. So in my patch, that would be the St James's Centre in Edinburgh in the East End. And so you're saying you're using public sector investment to catalyse private sector development. In the St James's Centre example, that's 60 million of public sector investment for a 1 billion private sector development. I'm wondering if you can explain just maybe briefly a little bit about the model and how that works. And also, what sort of benefit does the public sector get, or what return does the public sector expect for their investment?
Peter, do you want to?
Yeah, so the way that works fundamentally is to say that it's about the financial investment, but it's also about the confidence that comes from the public sector showing that, and in this case City of Edinburgh Council and the Scottish Government, showing that we have confidence in that area and in that investment. So the 60 million itself will go to enabling infrastructure that demonstrates commitment to the site and to the project going ahead, whether that be in the public realm or whether that be other infrastructure elements around the site. And the agreement to put that in place has caused the private sector to make that investment decision and to invest its funds there, rather than perhaps to develop a different site. They've got pretty mobile capital, they can deploy it wherever they wish. So we have shown that both by putting the money in and by showing the long-term confidence to that site, that's drawn in the £1 billion for around about 1.7 million square feet of retail, leisure and residential development in that area. The returns that will come for that to the public sector will be the returns that the public sector gets and the public as a whole gets from the economic growth that comes out of that development. So there will be an increased taxation take from the business rates and indeed the domestic rates if there's domestic development, but there will also be the jobs that come out of that and an ability to have quite a substantial amount of training done in that site, both in the long term and in the short term as it's constructed. So it's a whole series of wider ripples from the site itself in terms of the benefits of the economic uplift that it brings.
And just, I think at the moment, the confidence the cities are showing in actually attracting investment is such a key element. I think working with the cities, as well as with rural areas, but the cities in terms of drawing overseas, so the St James Centre, for instance, a Dutch pension fund has just recently bought into that, so 75% of the investment is now owned by a Dutch pension fund. And I think that's because it's been made an attractive place to invest. And I think sending a message to the market that we are serious about attracting investment through things like city deals, through things like Growth Accelerator and TIF. And we just launched two new calls for TIF pilots. These are all important signals to be sending to the investment community, whether that be UK or abroad, that Scotland's a good place to invest.
Just wind that out a little bit, because obviously you're involved in Dundee and Growth Accelerator work there, but there's also the Glasgow, Inverness, Aberdeen, and I declare an interest, the Stirling City region deals. What involvement have you got with these other areas which are involved in the city deals and trying to help them secure that additional impact for bringing private sector money to play in the way you've done in places like the St James Centre area?
So maybe I'll ask Peter to comment, but I think the city deals in Scotland are really a tripartite arrangement between the city region, UK government and Scottish government, and that's a sort of a crowded enough space as it is when you get a tripartite agreement. So we support the Scottish government and how it's structured, but the actual interface is led by Scottish government with UK government and the local authority group in the area. But so our expertise will go in to look at actually the robustness of the business plan and, you know, looking to say actually what are the capture mechanisms to say how do we know this is really having the effect, but we feed that into the Scottish government input into it.
You got anything to say in that addition, Peter?
Well, in areas such as Aberdeen, Inverness, we've been involved in specific elements where we have expertise, like the digital elements of that programme, to help the local authorities shape that investment to get the most boost from it. In the Stirling Clackmannanshire, we're probably slightly more involved at an early stage in helping the authorities develop their prioritised project list that they have identified, and help shape that to deliver the maximum impact for a set of projects.
Okay. Can I ask a quick follow-up on that? So I'm very encouraged to hear that, but one of the puzzles I have about the Glasgow City deal is that we have, I think, 20 or 22 projects which are at various stages of development, and getting any kind of transparency around why these projects were selected and what the ones are that are still on the cutting room floor in terms of the evaluation as to why these projects rather than others would be the ones to deliver the growth that the city deal is all about is quite a difficult process in the Glasgow case at the moment. Has there been any learning from city deal to city deal? Obviously Glasgow was the first one in Scotland, and we know that there have been others since, and that others are still in the pipeline, not only Stirling but also Edinburgh. Has there been any learning from one city deal to the next, in particular in this question of how you model the relationship between the infrastructure investment and the growth that you want to see as a result of the infrastructure investment?
And there will have been learning. There'll be learning between the cities through the City Alliance and other forums. We haven't been involved in the earlier deals. We've always had a view that the prioritisation of investment and doing the right things as well as just doing things well it's more important to do the right things than it is important to do the things that you're doing well. So we absolutely would support the route that Stirling and Clacks are going down and others hopefully in the future of trying to draw those direct lines between what our city or our city region or indeed any region, what our vision for that area is economically, what it's for, and whether there is any infrastructure barriers to that development and that vision, or what infrastructure investments or indeed other investments will support the vision, and drawing those lines between the projects. It's very hard to do it through an Excel spreadsheet or any sort of form of model, but the better we can get, I would agree with you, at drawing the direct lines between the economic outcomes we're looking for and the social outcomes we're looking for and the investment decisions we make, and transparency around that, we believe would be good progress, yeah.
I think it's probably true to say that some of the original deals emanated from political agreements to do things and didn't have the necessary business plans behind them. But more recently, the city deals that have emerged have had pretty well worked up business plans to work with. I think that's been one of the factors, certainly from my experience.
I would describe it as a journey, but I think
you're being more subtle, perhaps.
But I actually do subscribe to the view that it has, I think, made the cities much more outward-facing to investors and having a much clearer story, and the city region a much clearer vision and mooted plan or plan about how they are going to actually tackle some of the bottlenecks. And actually, I think if you're an investor coming to look at that, I think that's actually quite a positive story. You need to have the delivery falling behind the story. And I think the degree of rigour in the city deals
I said we weren't involved in Glasgow, but we are involved in the subsequent ones.
That mooted plan. It's an interesting terminology that says you agree with me, I think. Well, thanks very much. Thank you for coming and giving us evidence. I'm sorry it wasn't as broad-ranging as it might have been, but obviously there's an imperative here to understand a lot of the issues that are going on from different members. Thank you very much for coming along and giving us evidence today, and I hope you have a happy festive period. We'll now have a short suspension to allow for changeover of witnesses.
A very happy festive period to you all as well.
Okay, thank you. Okay, colleagues, the fourth item on our agenda is to take evidence on the draft budget for 2017-18 from a panel of stakeholders, and I welcome you all to the meeting. We have Colin Borland, who is the Senior Head of External Affairs at the Federation of Small Businesses in Scotland, Claire Mack, the Director of Policy and Place at SCDI, and Dave Moxham, who is the Deputy General Secretary of the SDUC. Welcome. Members have received copies of submissions from each of our witnesses. We'll try to make this as free-flowing as we can, and if somebody asks you a specific question of a specific member of the panel and you want to chip in beyond that, please feel free to do so. And we'll just get underway. And Adam Tompkins.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. Welcome to the committee. And thank you for your written submissions, all of which were very helpful. I want to ask a question about growth and the extent to which, if at all, you think that this is a budget for growth. So I was very struck by the FSB, who said in their written submission that they were very keen for the Scottish Government's spending plans to focus on measures that grow the economy and encourage the creation, sustainability and growth of business. The SCDI, right at the beginning of their submission, talk about the underperformance in the Scottish economy, particularly as regards productivity and innovation, and the SDUC in their submission also talk about the importance of growth policies. So the question, the opening question is this a budget for growth, and if it, is it a budget that is adequately, that adequately provides for growth in the Scottish economy, and if it doesn't, what more would you have wanted to see?
Colin, do you want to start off?
Thanks very much. I think, as you say, there were three things that we highlighted in our submission that we thought would be beneficial towards growth. First was maintaining a stable tax regime as far as possible in line with the rest of the UK, expanding the small business bonus scheme, getting best value out of money that's spent, so ensuring most, most of efficient joined-up government, a particular focus on digital public services, and thirdly, a focus on sort of local investment, particularly local infrastructure. So if you look at the budget, I think we've done okay. I mean, I know the arguments and tax were pretty finely balanced at a time when weak consumer demand and sluggish economic growth, you know, as dominating business owners' worries. Yeah, it might make sense to put more money into your customers' pockets by giving, using the tax powers and giving them a tax cut. On the other hand, at this time of economic fragility and political uncertainty, there's also merit in minimising, you know, uncertainty, disruption, extra admin for employers by keeping rates and thresholds the same as the UK. So I think in the absence of any sort of compelling modelling on either side, we ended up advocating the latter position, simply because our position is always to simplify the tax system where we can, not further complicate it, and because we haven't properly explored some of the maybe the full practical consequences of having divergence from the rest of the UK. Indeed, I noted in one of the Fraser-Valander Institute's commentary on the budget, the issue, and I'm sure you've explored it in details, but won't detain you with it, but the issue about the upper earnings limit for national insurance and how that, if that stays the same when the upper threshold for income tax in Scotland moves, then you can see some people with a marginal rate of 52%. So the fact that you've got things like that emerging probably shows it was the right thing to try and keep everything as uniform as we possibly could for the moment, not ruling it out in the future, obviously. So we welcome the fact that rates were maintained. Be interesting to see how this differential in the higher threshold plays out. And looking at things like, you know, obviously we welcome the small business bonus, the fact that we have seen the threshold for the 100% increase, 100% threshold increase from 10 to 15,000 is obviously good news if you look at the impact that's having on businesses up and down the country, particularly in some of our hard-pressed economic areas. That's got to be, I don't know if we'll talk about that more in detail, so again, I won't go into that in too much detail. Here, the extra money for broadband infrastructure and mobile infrastructure, again, was good news. Very quickly, we would like to have seen more stuff, I think more on local roads, particularly local infrastructure. that is where the productivity gains are to be had. That's where most journeys happen. That's where most delays happen. That would have been good news. And probably it wouldn't be fair to expect it to be outlined in a budget statement, but longer term, I think we do need to look at how we're delivering public services, where, particularly when times are tight, how we can get a little bit more value for the money that we are spending, and where things like duplication and overlap, especially around business support, but elsewhere as well, can be addressed.
We obviously have advocated growth as the key element of our statement that we made to you. The growth rate of about 1% this year sits about a third of the UK, and that's something that closing that gap is absolutely critical to the economic health of the country. And for us, productivity is absolutely key to that. Productivity is quite a difficult thing to unpack, but we've done a little bit of work on that. In terms of what we think is great about the budget is, support for infrastructure investment. We're absolutely keyed in there. One of the concerns that we've expressed is perhaps the support for the enterprise agencies, what we see as a particularly critical time for the Scottish economy, and that they are kind of the key drivers of productivity, innovation and internationalisation, and we're keen to see the support mechanisms for them as strong as possible. What we would potentially have liked to have seen is, we've argued in the past for a productivity commission for Scotland, and we still think that that would be a really useful plan for us to go forward, and we're keen to do some more work on that in the coming year. Absolutely echo the thoughts of Colin in terms of digital public services, with them making up such a huge part of the Scottish economy, and we know that productivity in that area is slightly different to what we see in productivity in the private sector. We think that there is certainly a way of reinvigorating and digitising public services that could create stronger economic growth and actually set us apart as a world leader in that particular area.
Yeah, points of agreement would be around infrastructure and digital. I won't repeat that. Frankly, though, if the aim is productivity, the amount of scrutiny that we're currently seeing, and in a somewhat rushed fashion, of the role of the enterprise agencies and the budget that we've seen here to match, compared to the complete lack of scrutiny on something like, I apologise to Colin in advance, the small business bonus scheme, which is assumed to deliver many of the things that it's claiming to do, but that's never been tested, never been examined by the Scottish Government or by anybody, I think, apart from the STUC. There's a real contrast there. If we're going to do that scrutiny, if we're going to invest that money, we have to show the same rigour in terms of both of those investment pools and both of those means of driving productivity. I still fail to see why the small business bonus scheme could be seen as something that is a particular contributor towards productivity. The other point we'd obviously make, and you expect us to say this, is that public services matter in terms of boosting productivity. The services they provide, the infrastructure they provide. This isn't a great budget for local government, and we think that that's a significant problem. And it's obviously not a great budget either for public service workers, who, if we're going to have some of the public service improvement that Colin talked about, need to do so from a stable basis where they can actually be contributors towards developing those public services rather than suffering from their cuts.
Well, thank you very much. There's a lot there to chew on, and I'm sure colleagues will want to pick up on a lot of different aspects of what you said. But can I just drill down into one or two aspects? First of all, infrastructure investment. And I think you were all in the back of the room when you heard the conversation in the end of the last panel about the relationship between infrastructure investment and growth. And, you know, some infrastructure investment leads to growth more quickly and more directly than others. I just wonder if you have any reflections on the kind of infrastructure, if growth is the priority, as at least two of you have said, if you have any reflections on the kind of infrastructure investment that we should be prioritising in this budget cycle.
Yeah, I mean, we, in our submission, made the point, as we made elsewhere, that if you're looking for bang for your buck, then you want to be looking at local infrastructure investment. I was struck by the point that Stephen Boyle of RBS...
I'm sorry to interrupt, but can you just explain what you mean by local infrastructure investment?
Bluntly, local roads.
Local roads.
Yeah, getting rid of Getting, yeah, 60% of our members do almost all their business locally. They all, you know, a great proportion rely heavily on cars and vans. That's where the delays occur. And when I was struck with what it was, Stephen Boyle at RBS made the point in an article earlier this year, where he said, you know, we know what sort of transport investment yield the highest returns, roads that unblock congestion, allowing the networks to flow more freely, because that's where the problems are, that's where people are getting head up, that's where the productivity losses occur. So if you want to free up small businesses to do what they do best, you know, make sales, get products delivered, and rather than sitting in traffic jams wasting their time, then that has got to be the way forward. There's a figure cited by Audit Scotland that for every £1 reduction in local road maintenance, there's a knock-on effect or knock-on cost to the local economy of between £1.67 and £1.76. So there is definitely, so you would expect the converse to be true as well. If we begin to invest in our roads, we should see productivity gains. So I think overall, that's where we'd like to see it. On the digital side, the debate about broadband is fascinating. We would just issue a plea not to forget about mobile, because particularly mobile data, really important, especially for all sorts of business, but particularly for tourism businesses, hospitality businesses, who rely on visitors to Scotland being able to get off the plane or off the train, have a look at their phone, look at Google Places and find out where they want to go that night. So that would be where we would like to see particular attention focused.
For us, we acknowledge and have acknowledged publicly that Scottish Government have placed more emphasis on infrastructure investment perhaps than the UK Government have in successive budgets, and we acknowledge as well that you know, budget package has been declining. Our thoughts on infrastructure are based more around the planning of infrastructure and trying to dovetail investments in different areas of the country to make sure that we get, you know, additional added value from them. And to that end, have suggested that a National Infrastructure Commission type body for Scotland could be helpful in that area, and acknowledge that as well that the SFT could potentially have a role to play in there. It's important to think about maintaining as well as building infrastructure. We do know that there's a differential in there as well in terms of what it can offer growth. We're very keen as well on developments in low carbon infrastructure. We see Scotland as holding a key strength in that area, and it's certainly something that globally is recognised, and we were very keen to see that those are maintained and supported. In terms of transport infrastructure, we've been looking at that in some depth over the last year. We've been doing a connectivity commission to look at not just roads, but rail, freight, all sorts of other new and future developments in that area. And note, you know, the UK government's support for developments in future transport options, and that's an area that we see as critically important going forward, can offer lots of efficiencies and give us new and innovative ways of doing things in that sense. Two things that have come out of there is that in order for us to get to where we would like to be in that world-class space, is digital infrastructure is critically important. It just feels like the no-regrets infrastructure spend, and an energy supply and security of energy supply is also very, very important and across the board for all of our infrastructure spending.
I'm fated to be last with our lists, so I'm really just going to add housing.
In terms of that issue around getting better value and the idea of the Productivity Commission, just can you bring that alive with some examples of where you mean we're not getting the best value we should be getting? So,
from a productivity perspective, I guess it would be, for us, the one that's on the table right in front of us is the digital public services productivity issue, and we know that if we can increase that productivity, we will be able to bring it on a bit faster than we can from the private sector. We absolutely acknowledge, and there's the Deloitte report that has been published that suggests that there is a certain amount of headcount reduction that will happen in there. We think that there's a time that we can use this to plan well. you know, all we have to do is look at the recent television programme on the council to see that actually it's not that easy to automate and bring robots in to do these sorts of jobs. They're very human front-facing jobs. What we're talking about is that there are some things that potentially could be automated, very transactional tasks that would free people up to do the more complex jobs and the more and address the more complex needs of the people in our society who rely on public services. So we're also doing a little bit of work into digital public services, which we hope to publish in Q1 of next year, and keen to get committee views on that.
Okay. I've got quite a number of people who want to come in. Ash?
Obviously, rates relief features in the draft budget. Obviously, there's going to be a change in the threshold, which will mean that more businesses will benefit. So this is really a question for the FSB about your submission. So you said that you recently carried out a survey of your members on the small business bonus scheme. Would you be able to give us a flavour of the sort of responses that you had?
Yes, delighted to. And just to get on the record, there's lots of people who have been looking at the small business bonus and its impact, including the FSB. And the most recent figures that we have are from this summer, when we asked 1,000 members about their experiences. And of that, 37% said that being in receipt of small business rates relief had let them invest in their business. 19% said they'd used it to invest in staff. And when we said to them, so what would happen if it was withdrawn? Then 20% say that that investment would be cancelled and 19% would have to close. So I think if that's not demonstrating a clear business case about the broader economic impact, I'm not sure what is. Because it's not just about the jobs and the businesses that we're sustaining ourselves. It's about all the, you know, this is what economists talk about, the velocity of money. It's about us out spending and hiring and also commissioning services, buying goods, investing in the business, and that sort of economic activity that we're trying to generate. And the other point about the small business bonus is it's about getting an element of proportionality or indeed or a redistributive element into the business tax system, because you either agree with tax thresholds or you don't. And we don't look at any other, we don't look at income tax thresholds and say that you can only get that if you spend it, the money that you would save on things of which we approve. So quite why we would do it with this particular property-based tax, I'm not entirely sure. So you know, I'm more than happy to robustly defend the impact of the scheme, which has been in existence now, as we know, for in one form or another, for about 13 years. Yeah.
So you've described it in your submission as a key support mechanism, but just to pick up on Dave Moxham's point earlier, do you think you can prove a link between, you know, the small business bonus scheme, what it's doing for small businesses across Scotland, and growth? And, you know, to pick up on that point about productivity, do you see a provable link there?
Definitely. The best evidence on this is to ask people who are on the front line and who are actually running businesses and know about what their margins are like and know what the effect, what this has allowed them to do, and indeed if it wasn't there, where they would have to find that money. Because if you're turning over 100 or so thousand a year operating a margin of 2 or 3%, those few thousand pounds can really make the difference. But almost impossible to attribute moves in the economy to any particular change, because there's an awful lot going on there. There are employability initiatives, there's the employment allowances, there's a raft of measures introduced, and economists can probably argue long into the night about proving a direct causal link between the two. But from where we're sitting, we can't see a better evidence source than asking people who know what they're talking about, the people who are on the front line doing the business, about what impact this is having for them and what would happen if it wasn't there.
You've got a different perspective on this. I suspect that Patrick Harvey's question around it might lead in to Dave being able to answer as well. So I'll go to Patrick.
Thank you.
Their discussion around.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. I've no doubt at all that if you ask people who've had a tax cut whether they like it, they'll say yes, they do like it. I was interested, though, that even your own figures, Colin, suggested that the large majority of the people you've spoken to don't even claim that the small business bonus has led to them investing or hiring additional staff. Let's assume that we all agreed the same amount of money could be ring-fenced for some kind of business rates relief scheme. Is it not reasonable to suggest that it could be designed better so that the vast bulk of what the public purse is paying for in a rates relief scheme does result in investment or increases in employment?
But yeah, I mean, I'd be happy. Just, I didn't want to detain the committee, but I can go through exactly how it is being spent. There's another chunk. You know, if you add in the 37% who've invested it, the 19% that have invested in staff, 37% invested in other aspects of the business, 35% using it to offset other increases in overheads, which we're seeing as well, which is crucial to business viability. There's a lot in there that demonstrates this is being well used. But your point about targeting, yeah, it's an interesting one, because it's the sort of thing that I think sounds interesting. So why wouldn't you have a targeted tax cut? I think there's two points. First one's a practical one about quite who would administer that. Because if we talk in the language about this being the public giving money to businesses, which again, it's not taking money from them, so it's not quite the same thing, but you know,
it's costing the public purse, yeah.
But notionally, right? But if we accept that if everything stopped tomorrow, if the small business bonus and small business rates really stopped tomorrow and everything else stayed the same, so no one would go out of business, no one would cancel any investment, that wouldn't have any knock-on effect on the rest of the public finances and the rest of the economy. If nothing else changed, then yes, you'd be talking about £174 million. Compared, incidentally, to a business rate take of £2.84 billion, so it was about 6% of that. Even if you got all of that money, what would the administration cost be of being able to define that scheme, administer that scheme? There's something like 99,500 recipients this year, and that's going to increase next year. So how would we go all round them to make sure they were the sort of businesses of which we approved and who we thought should be, were deserving of this?
Well, I'm sure that depends on the detail of the kind of relief scheme that you would want to design and what you'd be seeking to achieve rather than just cutting everybody's tax bill on a blanket basis. I wonder if Dave might
make the second point about, yes, there's a practical point and how much this would be eaten up by the administration. But secondly, there's a point about the fairness and the point of that we don't assess tax thresholds, any other sort of tax threshold, against behaviour of which we happen to approve, because that's not what the scheme is designed to introduce. It's there to introduce an element of proportionality, an element of redistribution into a tax which is disproportionately difficult for the smallest businesses, and particularly the smallest businesses operating in the toughest circumstances.
Yeah, I mean, as Patrick implies, asking somebody who's just asked you for a bar of chocolate if they like chocolate is probably not the perfect foundational base. I know that Colin's spoken to his members, and I don't doubt some of the uses to which those resources have been put to. And I want to make very clear, we're certainly not anti-small business. But to be frank, when you hear figures about people using this to pay overheads, One response to that is that's keeping some good businesses alive. One response to that being frank is it's keeping some bad businesses alive. Two, there is an awful lot of competition and poor competition going on amongst small businesses, which we don't necessarily want to sustain with, I agree with Patrick, what should be thought of as a public contribution. Now, I can't design a new scheme off the top of my head, but I do know that I used to be involved in the Future Jobs Fund, and what the Future Jobs Fund used to do was it used to ask a whole range of businesses to come to it, a whole range of public sector organisers, and it said, we are prepared to give you some money to create jobs as long as you're prepared to show us what you're going to use that job for. And it wasn't a particularly high overhead scheme. So the idea that you can't design something that people can come to you to apply for and to say we intend to use this for a purpose that will create a good and decent job in the pursuit of a stable small business seems to me that idea doesn't seem to me to be beyond the wit. Again, just to return to this point of the enterprise agencies, the enterprise agencies are being looked at in very keen detail just now. Big questions are being asked about how they should be investing, whether they should be able to be prepared to take risks or not. That level of scrutiny should be applied to this rebate too.
Did you want me to come to income tax later or just now?
Because I know Murdo's also interested in that area.
Okay. So you want to... I was certainly interested in the STUC's comments on income tax. I think you said that it was that it's not the ideal circumstance at the moment, or not the ideal economic conditions for an increase in the basic and higher rates. Now, I would certainly agree that an increase in the basic rate would impact on a great many people who are already struggling, particularly at the lower half of the income scale. The lowest four deciles of society are already being hit by difficult circumstances, are looking at the prospect of inflation coming down the road, and are having their incomes reduced by choices that the UK government has made. I'd have to say it's not a requirement under the new legislation that we only have one basic rate, and a more progressive approach could be used. But I wonder if you'd like to elaborate on why you think it's the wrong time to be increasing the higher rate when high earners have also had their incomes increased by the UK government's choices. Isn't it the right time to be reversing that?
I need to hurry to look through my notes because, as far as I'm concerned, we're saying that it's difficult conditions in which to do that, but that it should be done. So we advocate, and if it doesn't say that in the submission, it really should. We advocate the use of the 50p rate, and we're advocating the increase of the basic rate by 1p as well. What we're doing in our paper is recognising that that's not an easy decision to make in the current economic circumstances. So I don't know if that kind of helps.
Okay, that's certainly clearer. Mm. I would have argued that it's actually very easy to make the case, given that high earners have had their incomes increased by the UK government. It's pretty easy for me, I think, to make the case that the Scottish government could do something that reverses that concentration of wealth. It's not just about fairness. It's about whether the wealth of the economy is going to be more concentrated in fewer hands and therefore less productive.
But we're agreeing about the use of the measure. Yeah.
Thank you.
I want to comment upon that before I come to Murdo on that vehicle. No? Okay, Murdo?
Well, thank you, Convener. Well, perhaps I could ask the same question as Patrick, but in a slightly different way and from a slightly different perspective. And maybe start off with Claire Mack, because in the SCDI submission, you make the point a number of times about the need for Scotland to remain competitive to attract both investment and talent. What we have seen in this budget, and indeed in previous policy announcements, are a number of differential tax proposals from the Scottish Government. So we've seen Derek Mackay propose that the increase in the threshold for the higher rate of tax will not be matched by the Scottish Government. We've seen LBTT rates in Scotland that are higher than they are south of the border. And we've seen on business rates the continuation of the large business supplement, albeit its reach has been reduced in terms of the latest budget, but it will remain at double the UK rate. Do you have any view, maybe start with yourself, Claire Mack, do you have any view on what these measures mean for the competitiveness of the Scottish economy?
Yeah, I think we're looking at everything in kind of a holistic pattern, in that we're obviously working with businesses, so there's a consumer element to this as well, but focusing on businesses just now, that there are a lot of things that businesses are expected to do and a lot of things that they do gladly. We don't see a lot of businesses looking to shut up shop as a result of any of these things, but some of our members are certainly coming to us and explaining that they find this is making it more difficult for them to do business. So we need to look at where the growth areas are, and places like retail. 13% of new firms last year were from the retail sector, and they're one of our largest private sector employers. So obviously for them, the large business supplement is a very big issue. The other thing obviously is that link, the behavioural link to taxation, and we need to be very clear in Scotland that we've got absolutely good and strong data as to how these things are impacting particularly on businesses, but also on individuals and households. You know, we live very close to our nearest neighbour, and that mobility of capital, that mobility of people is actually relatively easy, and that's one of the points that I think has definitely come out. We need to be quite clear as well that, that in our economy we can see the real fluctuations between sectors very, very easily because of its current fragility, and that's kind of an issue that's part of the kind of global part as well. So we need to be very good care and when we make these decisions. We're still seeing growth at the moment supported by consumer spending, which is where income tax is interesting. I think, again, difficult decision to make, not suggesting it's the right or the wrong decision. I think it, when faced with a set of different things to think about, you do have to, you know, the high rate of income tax is always the one that, that tends to take the attention and tends to kind of be the one that's that takes the marginal rate hit. Again, I would say we need to be very clear about the behavioural impacts that could result in that, either through avoidance or potentially for migration of incomes and whatever. One of the things that, you know, in doing some sort of research into our sort of looking into this, the consumer spending issue, you know, in Scotland we've got lower saving ratios, and with weak wage growth we've got to be really clear about what the difficulties are with all of this, and we need to be clear about the link between household disposable incomes and growth for our entire economy.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry.
Colin Borland.
Could I just follow up
we'll let you come back and let others respond first.
Yeah, but I think I can't remember who it was that said that economics is the art of telling everyone what's going to happen then explaining why it didn't, but I was struck by the point in the Fraser of Allender submission that the behavioural consequences of changes, particularly in a devolved setup where you've got control over some levers and not others, can be greater than you might expect or can certainly be harder to establish. So that's why, as I said in my opening answer to Mr. Tompkins, that's why, on balance, we came down on the side of saying at the moment no change is probably the best thing to do this year. Because, yeah, I take your point about putting more money in people's pockets has got to be a good thing. But given some of the anomalies, like the national insurance one that I mentioned earlier, that we are seeing emerging, given the fact that I certainly didn't see any robust modelling on either side of the argument saying this would be a particularly good or bad thing to do. We came down to that, given everything else that's going on at the moment, given the fact that where possible I would like to simplify things rather than make them more complicated, on this occasion this was the correct thing to do.
Sorry, what was the correct thing to do?
Sorry, to maintain the rates. To maintain the rates in step with the rest of the UK. Right. In an ideal world, we would have maintained the income tax ban thresholds as well. But we'll see how that plays out in practice.
Well, I think it's just worth pointing out that reducing taxes and putting more money in people's pockets doesn't increase the quantum of money in the economy. It just changes the way that it's spent. Our view would be, which is why we actually advocated increases in taxation, although modest, is that this is a particularly good time for the type of investments that we need in people, frankly, that government and local government are very good at, and which show very, very significant outflows in terms of benefits. So, you know, none of this is a question about increasing the quantum. None of us have got the real anti-austerity tools at our disposal here. But, you know, our view, our considered view, even in the current economic climate, is that transfer of resources towards equalisation and towards public investment is the best choice that we could make.
Question.
It was just to clarify one point which Claire made. You made the argument about the potential mobility of high-income individuals and whether the implication that the revenues would go down. From the evidence that the committee has seen, there is a question mark about that at the additional rate band, the very highest earners. It's a question mark rather than absolute clarity. A lot of the discussion ends up with the phrase, we just don't know. I'm not aware of having seen anything that shows there's evidence that that effect would happen at the higher rate rather than the additional rate. And we were talking about a modest increase in the higher rate as one of the options. Are you aware of evidence that 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 kind of effect would happen at the higher rate rather than the additional rate?
I've only looked at evidence probably more broadly than Scotland. I don't have anything that would suggest that there would be any particular Scottish element to that. I think what is known sort of internationally is that particularly in American and their taxation system is different to ours, I do acknowledge, is that it's not necessarily that they would be more mobility, it's potential for avoidance. People who have got the ability to book their income slightly differently and are able to kind of take advantage of tax reliefs potentially will do in those instances.
Wouldn't but necessarily apply to someone who's just on a salaried position
on a PAYE.
45 grand, say.
Right, okay. I mean, just, and it is worth pointing out the high density of those types of jobs, which don't, you can't carry the types of jobs that Patrick's referring to around in a suitcase. They're Scottish jobs, which will remain Scottish jobs.
Murdo?
Yeah. Just a slightly different question for Colin Borland on business rates. The budget proposes matching the rest of UK business rate, which I'm sure will be welcome to your members, but of course we have a revaluation due next year. I've certainly already picked up from constituents, particularly in the hotel sector, concerns about potential substantial rises in their rates bills because of the revaluation. I'm just wondering if you had any sense from your own members what their feeling was about the overall burden of business rates. Obviously, those who are in the small business bonus scheme will not have this impact, but many of your members will be at a scale beyond that, particularly in retail and hospitality. Do you have any sense of what their rates bills are likely to be looking at after their evaluation?
Well, obviously, we've just seen the draft revaluations been published on the assessor's website, so I would imagine that people have not quite been queuing up to have a look at them just yet. In the new year, we will be doing a lot of work to make sure people are looking at them, and if they think they're wrong, doing something about it. I think you're right. I think some of the things we have looked at might suggest that there might be issues in particular sectors. At the moment, the government and ministers have the advantage on us because they've had the data for a while. They know what the impact's going to be. So we have to take them at their word when they say that something like a transitional relief scheme wouldn't be appropriate, particularly as that would tend to be funded by the winners subsidising the losers. And of course, all of the other calculations about poundage and everything else will make a lot more sense when we get a feel for what the new rateable values are going to be. However, as always the way with counter-cyclical taxes, it's unlikely that lots of people are going to see the rateable values drop.
Okay, thank you. Maybe that's something you can come back to the committee on in the new year once you've had a chance to look at the figures.
I think it's almost certain we're going to be looking at this in a lot of detail, so yes, I'd be more than happy to, if you let us know exactly what it is you're looking for.
Well, revaluation increases in some areas, big surprise. No, really. It always happens, doesn't it? So there's going to be winners and there's going to be losers. But Neil?
We've talked about, obviously, growth and productivity in terms of the impact that will have on revenues, Adam. Tompkins started that off. Colin, you mentioned the importance of local roads, and Dave, you mentioned housing. I just wanted to ask, would it be fair that we need to give greater consideration of the local government settlement, which shouldn't just be about the focus on spending on services, but about the impact that can have for investment on local roads and housing and in turn, how much productivity and growth can be generated locally.
Dave, you want to kick off?
I mean, local authorities, as the drivers of local growth, are absolutely vitally important. Slightly surprised that, for instance, the Business Gateway was left out of the enterprise review, so interested to see where that sits. And yeah, I mean, we're obviously concerned about the quantum of the local government settlement. I know there's been various interpretations of how that should be seen, and there are good things happening. The Scottish Government budget has done some good things. We're very very clear that the investment in the living wage for another year in social care, as long as it's properly implemented, will help to drive equality, but also to drive growth. But overall, if you're asking for, are we concerned at the level of investment that local authorities will be able to make in their staff and their services, then the answer is yes.
We obviously are working with a number of local authorities on their city region deals and that kind of thing. So the economic development functions that sit in local government are key interest to us, and obviously their role in addressing inequality. We live in very constrained times and accept that the reductions to local government budgets are potentially going to have an impact at that end.
Yeah, I mean, I think economic development spending goes way beyond the traditional sort of enterprise network, and it does include everything from potholes to primary schools and an awful lot in between. I think the more that we look at where we've maybe gone wrong in terms of our economic development strategies in recent decades, the more that we are coming round to the view that focus on the local and to what's happening in particular local economies is going to be much more important than, for example, looking for the next grand design. So yeah, absolutely, this sort of that economic regeneration game is a package deal that everyone has got something to contribute to.
Just tell us a bit more about what the SCDI are doing around the city deals, because obviously I think from the evidence we heard earlier, from Colin just saying, Dave just said, these are going to be pretty important determinants of driving economy forward and increasing productivity. So what's been the SCDI's role on that with the local authorities?
We've been working most specifically with the Ayrshire Growth deal, and we're doing some work now with the Tay Cities deal to help them think about private sector investment, how to attract more businesses to their area, how to assess their strategic cases, business cases, to try and get as much additional value out of them as possible. So we've been, we've had somebody seconded actually directly into these projects to help do business engagement as well, to try and draw together business view as to what would help the regions that they're located in, what would help their employees, what would help them grow their businesses as part of the city deal mechanism.
Thank you. Dean, I think you had a question.
Yes, a slightly different question in relation to the role of the enterprise agencies. The enterprise, looking at the enterprise budget has been cut by £85 million across Scottish Enterprise, HIE and, I guess, Business Gateway. Given the need to increase exports, productivity, internationalisation, can I get your thoughts about if there is going to be a lower level of enterprise support, what are the key areas we should be prioritising, what we should be ring-fencing in a tighter budgetary environment?
We've obviously identified that as one of our issues that's come through from the budget, is that by any calculation, it seems to be a 30% reduction. And we do have to question the ability for the agencies to deliver there. In terms of prioritisation, it's very similar to what we've put forward in our blueprint document, which, you ask for it all, and we would hope that it would all be there. It's just productivity, innovation and internationalisation are the three key things that we think are important for the Scottish economy to grow. Productivity in particular will have that impact on wage growth, which is what we need, which will feed through obviously into taxation growth, which should help public sector revenues.
As I said to Mr. Bibby, the economic development spending goes way beyond what goes to enterprise network, and as somebody who's sat in front of this committee and others for many years making the point that in its current incarnation, the relevance of SE with its very specific remit on specific types of businesses and specific work means that it's of less direct relevance to our members. And it wouldn't be consistent for me to then sit here and say, well, if it's got this cut in its budget, that's somehow a disaster for us. However, if we are looking at ways that money can be better spent, the enterprise review and indeed the Audit Scotland report that preceded that, I would imagine is a pretty rich seam to mine, because we do see things like identified SE high and Scottish Government all having sort of specialist growth teams who are delivering very similar things. I mean, for example, Scottish Government spends 11 million a year delivering grants and activities for the food and drink sector, although the three sector teams will communicate and collaborate in specific pieces of work, there is duplication of effort because they're all running about doing research and analysis and doing liaison with different organisations. So there's probably, and I think this will probably come out in the second stage of the enterprise review, that there is significant potential to deduplicate and streamline and focus those efforts.
Is that new word in the lexicon?
I don't have a great deal to add on that question.
Dave?
Peter, okay. To rest on that.
Dean, you all right? Willie?
Convener, is this to continue with the theme of my question from the previous panel, and where I understand you were all agreed in your opening some of your initial responses on digital public services and that investment there. Who do you think, you know, the potential consequences could be for Scotland if the UK was to pull out of something like the digital single market? I mean, are we inextricably linked to that in terms of technology and infrastructure investment, and how on earth could you pull away from that, really, is a question that we should be asking ourselves. But what do you think the implications for Scotland's economy might be if that were the direction of travel that we were to face?
I think there's a lot in there. You know, digital is something that I am a huge proponent of in terms of that productivity piece as well. I thought it was interesting when Barry White was talking about private sector investment, and it is true to say that private sector investment has certainly been in there and has given us a boost. I mean, the most recent Ofcom figures show, you know, phenomenal increases in some of our rural areas. I guess what we have to remember is that the commercial investment in those areas was actually initially zero. And it wasn't until both came in at the same time that that's made something happen, and that very much was part of that EU framework and EU thinking about what the aspiration is from a digital point of view. I think in terms of a digital economy for Scotland, we need to start thinking a bit bigger, particularly with the potential impact of Brexit coming along, which is that we focus very much on consumer-led rollout and availability and skills, which I think is absolutely valid. I think we do need to get some good data on business connectivity and business availability, and how we can make sure that is exactly how we need it to be for our businesses to trade internationally very successfully. There's also some opportunities potentially from the slightly different stance that Scotland is taking, opportunities in there for particular sectors, and some of whom are particularly reliant on very, very good digital infrastructure to locate here.
Dave, Colin?
Can't match that level of expertise, I'm afraid.
In terms of the impact that new technology has on people with disadvantaged communities and so on, there's a huge divide there, we know about it. But the impact that technology can have can help bridge those gaps, and it can enable people to access public services, and it can enable people to work and to trade and buy online. Do you think that's a crucial factor in taking Scotland's economy forward? And what is the implications of us not being part of that European agenda if we lose that?
For us, it is about that aspiration towards world class, and digital is a brilliant leveller for that. You know, we are smaller, we do have a particular sort of geography that we need to contend with, but digital can help level out all of that, and I think that's where it's important. I think there is some scope for us to develop digitally. I, you know, 100% agree with you that it could have massive impacts on inequality done well. You know, it's about that equality of availability as well. And I think for us, we're keen to see some really, really good data. There is already good data at kind of postcode level. We don't deny that, but it would be great to see cuts of that data to look at the business sector as well. I think there is potential from a regulatory point of view to perhaps take an innovative approach, not necessarily reliant on population and geographic targets, which we know for Scotland are incredibly difficult because of the way that our population is dispersed. It does mean that you can hit kind of UK level targets and even Scotland level targets and still leave a lot of the areas unserved that we would like to see served. So I think particularly in mobile and thinking about upcoming mobile auctions, we would be keen to see some innovative thinking either on how the spectrum is allocated or just on some of the conditions that are placed on mobile operators, because for us the best option, I suppose, is the hard fibre option. It's got the resilience in there, it's got lots and lots of capacity in there, and it is a great investment from that point of view. Mobile is also very, very critically important, particularly for, as Colin has said, small businesses who are very mobile, and particularly for businesses as well that we would want to see grow.
Just on the question of e-government specifically, yeah, I think you're right. There's a massive potential here for what we could do, what resources that we could free up and allocate elsewhere if we got the e-governance side of business, or sorry, of government sorted out. And it's fair to say, I don't think we've really scratched the surface in Scotland in terms of what's about. One example, to return to business rates, there's about three different bits of government you have to engage with to check, appeal, pay your bill. Why on earth couldn't you put that through a single portal that someone can go on and say, oh yes, that looks about right, I've paid it and go on and move on. Why is that so difficult? And our experience of this is, while we've all tried to cajole and encourage and sort of through the use of appealing to people's better instincts, get them to cooperate a bit better and to sort of play towards the same agenda, it's been really, really difficult. And I would suggest that if we don't see an improvement soon, then the Scottish Parliament could be thinking about some sort of statutory duty on public bodies to play together and work towards that, you know, and to cede a little bit of authority to each other to sort of deliver on some of these common projects. Because as you say, when money's tight and we're needing to get money to frontline services in the most vulnerable in our community, this has got to be a prime candidate. Okay.
Just to add, I'm a bit worried about your statutory instruments there, Colin, but I mean, I do think there's a real point here, and it's a mantra that I've repeated at various committees, that the staff that are involved in delivering at the front end are properly involved in the process of doing the sort of things that Colin wants to. I think too often we lose the expertise of the people who are actually doing the work at the front line because middle managers provide blockages, so very keen to see the front line staff involved in that sort of discussion.
Okay, thanks, convener. The Scottish Government wage forecasts over the period to 2021 are that, in terms of public sector wage position, that would remain static at 2.2%, but the private sector wage growth would grow to a rate of 4.9%. Do you think that's a desirable policy outcome from the budget process?
I mean, more wage growth in both sectors is obviously what we'd like to see, and it is absolutely vital that wages continue to grow in the private sector, particularly if they're in that better quality job that we're driving towards, that better quality job that we require for more productivity. My fear in the private sector is that we won't see that sort of wage growth in services, and part of that will be because of poor employment regulation that allows that to happen, notwithstanding the fact the Scottish Government has limited powers to deal with that. I mean, turning to the public sector, it is a major concern. We do believe that the public sector pay cap should have been lifted. We do believe that there's going to be two major outcomes. Number one, obviously suffering for our members, but number two, a drawing of resources from the local communities that we talked about earlier. Significantly concerned that's the trajectory. Recognise the fact that some of that, indeed a significant part of that, is imposed on the Scottish Government by the UK Government, and that they have limited room for manoeuvre. But we would certainly be arguing for the lifting of the public sector pay cap and a slightly more generous offer to our members.
Either two of you want to? I guess, though, the inevitable follow-up to that, though, is then, in terms of where we are in the public sector in general, the difference in approach between the Scottish Government and the UK Government around the no compulsory redundancy issue in the public sector is something that
I mean, I'd like to put a number of things on record to repeat the point I made earlier about the Scottish Government's living wage commitment and the additional commitment to care workers. The no compulsory redundancy guarantee has been important. So to make the case that, A, the Scottish Government is not motivated to do some good things for public service workers, or that it has a free hand to do anything it wants, would be entirely correct. But we do believe at this point that the pay trajectory that James described is something that needs to be looked at very carefully.
Okay, I haven't had any indication from anybody else they want to contribute, so can I wish our panellists a happy festive period, and thank you very much kindly for coming along today to give us evidence. I now suspend this meeting, but we'll move into private. We'll move into private very quickly, though, rather than have a break. So thank you very much.